welcome into Vassar Linwood High School on the campus of Vassar High School. My name is Aaron Berlin. I'm joined alongside by my color analyst for this evening, Andrew Hammond, for district play round one, featuring the Vassar Linwood Bobcats and the visiting Jefferson West Tigers.
Yeah, of course, I like to call this the second season. Of course, you know, you have your regular league play, but then you go into district play. This is where a team like Jeff West, perfect example, can really get into the playoffs with one or even two wins. We'll explain that as the broadcast goes on, but you know, this Vassar Linwood team, after facing Mill Valley, I think we both agreed their toughest test so far, past that with flying colors, now they're flying to district play undefeated.
Jefferson West comes into this game on a three-game losing streak. Their last loss, a 33-26 loss against fellow Big 7 opponent Royal Valley. For Vassar Linwood, they come into this game off a big win over fellow 810varsity.com top 25 partner in Mill Valley. That was a big win last week. A lot of people thought it was for the Columbine League title. It turned out to be that way. Vassar went on a 20-0 run in the second quarter and never looked back. Vassar will receive, for the first go-around here, 11 or 12 minutes left to go on the clock. The kicker for the Tigers is Rowan Herring. He's a senior, one of few seniors for this Tiger offense.
The clock is still running. The clock needs to reset. There we go. It is back to 12 minutes. We were at 11:49. I was like, that's awesome. You start 11 seconds a little too late in a football game that hasn't kicked off.
Back to receive for the Bobcats are Alex Jackson as well as Skyler Ross. Ross on the near side, Jackson on the left hash mark. Kick by Herring up, and it's a beauty. High end over end kick, going to be taken by Ross. Ross about the 20-yard line, front and center, angles right, still on his feet, breaks one tackle, finds a hole across the 40, the 45, and he cuts up. Oh, my. Logan Herring caught him by a shoestring.
Yeah, typical shoestring tackle on that play. We could have had ourselves some fireworks early on, but, you know, once again, the Vassar offense goes to work. This Murphy-to-Murphy connection, Vassar has worked all season long. We talked to the coaches from Jeff West, and they said, you know, one of the things that they're going to do is blitz heavily in this one, so we'll see what they do in this first series.
A team that's averaging around 40 points for the year comes out for the first time this game. Colin Murphy goes under center, sends a man in motion. The pitch will go to Skyler Ross. Ross angles left side across the 50, still on his feet, where he's tripped up. He got across the 50 into Tiger territory at about the 49. 0-0 score here in the first quarter. District play round one, 11:36 left to go as the clock continues to tick. You're just now joining us. Welcome into 810varsity.com. Vassar in their all-green uniforms. Handoff going to go. Angles right side, still on his feet, pushing forward. Looks like Drew Potter might have been the man selected on the carry. Potter, of course, a 6'4", 217-pound junior, one of the few juniors that make up this Bobcat team, a team that's filled with 22 seniors this year. Talking to Jefferson head coach Steve Johnson, he said that's one of the big things, is they're mainly a team that is comprised of sophomores. They're going to have to come up here into the city and play the senior-led team. He said it's something that they've been using the Goliath or David versus Goliath analogy and in hopes to get his team up for this one.
Looks like we have a little bit of a stoppage in play so far. Looks like we had an official's timeout trying to get things settled. But definitely, you're right, Aaron. A team like Jeff West, that, you know, that does have some talent. Their quarterback, you know, has done pretty good so far this season. We'll see how they do on offense. But Vassar, of course, is on offense first. And it looks like we have the Mercer-to-Murphy, Ben Johnson, who had an excellent game against Mill Valley last week with the catch.
Nice throw by Colin Murphy. Threw it about the 45-yard line where Ben Johnson was waiting. It goes for a Vassar-Linwood first down. 11 minutes left to go, first and 10, ball at about the 37-yard line. Shotgun formation for the Bobcats, one tight end set. Pass is going to go near side. Throw is completed to Tanner Garver, the junior. It was a low throw by Colin Murphy. Garver had to go down and get it and barely got the hands on it. It'll go for a gain of 2 yards. Second and 8, ball at the Jefferson City 45-yard line. Shotgun formation, one tight end set. Pitch going to go to Potter. Potter right up the middle, across the 30, to the 25, to the 15, to the 10. Touchdown, Vassar. There was one man that could have got to him, but he didn't quite have the steps to get to him.
And as we can hear over the fireworks, I don't know, Aaron, if you saw that lane. I wish we had the telestrator. We could go back and watch that. That offensive line, they did a beautiful job on that drive. Every single time there was a run, the holes were just wide open for those runners to go through. And, I mean, the offensive line, if you want to give kudos to somebody and give the helmet sticker, they played excellent on that first drive today.
Mike, Nick Baranek was the young man on the coverage there that was the only one that was going to be able to stop Drew Potter. He was step for step with him. Potter just a little bit faster. Murphy rolls out near side, looking to throw. The right-handed quarterback on his legs gets past the goal line, and Jeff Finn will go for a two-point conversion for Baser. So something they've done all year long, score on the early drive and get the visiting team down. 10:28 left to go, first quarter of play, 8-0 lead for the Baser and Linwood Bobcats here on 810varsity.com.
I believe the kids would call that quick work, and we didn't even go through the offensive starters in this one.
We didn't have a chance to really tell you about anyone. Of course, Jefferson West comes into this game 3-3, losing their last three games. They're going to have a challenge on their hands here today as they take on number 8 in the 810varsity.com top 25 poll presented to you by the Kansas City Command. Baser comes into this game 6-0, and they're all green uniforms with green helmets with a yellow bobcat on the sleeve. For Jefferson West, they come in their black road or white road tops, black pants, and a black helmet. Mostly a sophomore-led squad. Tyler Ogden comes on to do the kicking duties for the Bobcats. Back to return are Drake Beard as well as Brannick. Brannick back, and he's going to let it bounce right in front of him about the 19-yard line before it bounces out of play. Good read there by Brannick to let that ball go ahead and bounce out. Bounce about 7 yards in front of him.
Yeah, and the guy I'm excited to see is number 10, Ian Mullins, the quarterback. He broke some school records last week, passing for over 300 yards in an unfortunate loss. But, you know, it'll be fun to see what this offense does. It looks like we are going to be kicking it again, so we're going to have to wait and wait just another play to see what this offense can do.
Looks like Jefferson City West wanted a do-over on that one. They want to get a chance to get the ball into the hands of Baranek as well as Beard. Correction, Wyatt Miller. So they'll bring the ball back to the 35-yard line where Tyler Ogden will come on. The ball is right at the near side hash mark on the right side. Ogden, fairly tall in stature, gets his right hand set to signal this one up and away. Ogden comes on. He has the signal from the referee. Good line drive kick going to be taken. And Baranek going to have to go back a little bit for this one. At the 10, across the 20, angles near side, hit in the backfield. And never had a chance to get those legs moving.
I believe that was number 11, Logan Herring, on the return.
Logan Herring on the return for that one. Herring never had a chance to quite get those big legs moving.
Packers will start off on the 24-yard line.
Going to start on the 24-yard line. So the first time to see the young man in Ian Mullings. He was named the Offensive Player of the Week after breaking a school record for over 300 yards passing. Jefferson City West, we were talking to their head coach, they're going to be a team that doesn't like to run the ball a whole lot. They say it's hard coming up here on the east side of the state where a lot of these teams run a spread offense. Mullins goes under center for the first time. The handoff is going to go Baranek. Baranek up in close to the middle. Maybe gets to the 30-yard line, but good yardage on first down. So it'll be second and four. It'll go for an official gain of 6 yards. Ball right before the 30-yard line. It's about an inch off right center in the field. Tigers will be working right to left across the screen. They're right in the middle of the field. Big Bobcat right about the 50-yard line. Mullins goes under center once again. One setback, one tight end, and he's got a receiver to the top of your screen. Handoff will go to Baranek. Baranek angles right side across maybe to the 45 to the 46. There's a hanky on the field, though.
Got a flag on the play.
Trying to see what this one is. Looks like we may have a face mask, and yes, we do. It looks like that will be on Baser Linwood.
It'll be a face mask against Baser Linwood. That'll go for a 15-yard penalty after the play. 8-0 Baser in favor of this one. 9:39. They scored on an early Big scoring drive by Drew Potter, who ran for about a gain of 25 yards.
Yeah, and like we said, they made quick work. I believe that was maybe four or five straight plays where they just ran the ball through it a few times. But just the offensive line was just moving excellently. But, you know, let's see what this offense from Jeff West can do on their first series.
Mullins under center once again. The handoff going to go to Hughes. Hughes across the 45, trying to get to baser territory. Couldn't quite do it, but good yardage on first down once again.
And one of the things I like right now what Jeff West is doing, they're slowing the game down at their pace. I think if they get into a score fest or, you know, a little shootout, that can get them into trouble. If they can shorten the game a little bit and keep that powerful Bobcat offense up the field, I think they really, you know, extend their chances of winning this one.
We're right under 9 minutes of play left to go first quarter. Tigers driving for the first time here today. They gave up a big touchdown to Baser on the first time. Mueller works trying to get some yardage as he took the handoff right up the middle. Had nothing doing, though, as a slew of Baser defenders were right there to tackle him. So it'll be third down at about six. Big third down right here for the young Tigers. 8:35 left to go, first quarter. As Mullins gathers the troop in the huddle about the 35-yard line.
Yeah, one of the things, they don't want to stretch them too deep, so you're probably going to see some slants, you know, some curls. This Baser Linwood team, especially in the secondary, probably one of the best teams in the state. They've gotten a huge turnover so far, and looks like we have an I formation too.
The pitch will go to Hewers, angles near side across the 50. He's got enough of the first down, still on his feet across the 45, and a Baser territory before he's brought down about the 42-yard line. Baranek, the big man, the senior, one of the few seniors on this team. They only have about two or three on there.
Number 22, Zach Smith on the tackle.
Zach Smith, the sophomore, able to get in there on a tackle for the Bobcats. All right at about the 41-yard line in Baser territory for the first time today. Brett Rickleff comes into the game for the first time. Tigers break the huddle, and Mullins will go under center under the big man and Branson Voss. Strong eye formation, two receivers to the top of your screen. Mullins barks out the order, fake handoff, it'll go to Huter. Huter right up the gut, maybe gets a couple of yards. Didn't have much room to work on that one as the holes quickly collapsed.
Yeah, one of the things I'm seeing so far in the series is that something that, you know, few teams have been able to do against Baser, run between the tackles very, very well. A lot of teams have been running to the outside so far. You know, a team that reminds me of Turner, they ran to the outside a lot and were effective, but could never get it inside the tackle. So Jeff West can, you know, keep doing that. Maybe they can try and wear him down a lot easier.
Jefferson West knew they were going to have to shorten this game if they were going to have any kind of a chance, and that's what they've done. They have yet to throw the ball. Handoff will go on your side across. Maybe to the 45, maybe got back to the initial line of scrimmage. It might go for a loss. Mick Baranek was on the carry on that one as he tried to get to the near side corner. Didn't have enough to cut it, though. Ben Johnson, the big man, the senior, was in on the tackle. 8-0 score in favor of the Bobcats. It'll be third down and six from the 37-yard line. The ball is right on the left hash mark. Ian Mullins, the sophomore, the leader for this team. This is his first drive. They've already converted on one big down, one third down conversion. Can they do it again? Strong eye formation set. One tight end to the far side. Your receiver on the near side is Drew Slimmer. Handoff will go across the 30 to the 25. Still on his feet. Gets a tackle. Piggyback tackle, though. Is Logan Herring the senior?
Yeah, I figured on that play they may give him a little play action, but you know they ran a nice little reverse from the far side to the near side. But so far, you know, this Jeff West team is very, very impressive. And like I said, they're taking on that David versus Goliath type feel, and they're really relishing it so far in this first series.
Head coach Steve Johnson said that's what he was pitching to his team beforehand, that they are David coming into Goliath, and they got a big task on their hand if they're going to win this one. High formation set once again. Mullins is thrown once. Handoff will go to Mueller right up the middle. Maybe gets two. Mueller's done a good job on those first down, trying to keep those legs moving and get a couple of yards because it's helping them tremendously on third down. So they'll go for an initial pickup of two. 5:45 left to go, first quarter. Second and 8 from the 16-yard line. Ian Mullins, the young sophomore quarterback, has looked fabulous here today. Him as long as Nick Branick, the senior. These two have been a tandem in the backfield. Mullins breaks the huddle and goes under center once again. He's got Hewer right behind him, and about 10 yards deep is Herring. Hand off a go. Fake handoff. Going to throw. End zone. Watch Baranek. Tips it off the middle of his arm on the far side. Oh, my. Baranek wanted to catch it right at about the 2-yard line, but Zach Smith saved that reception.
And simply, Baranek just heard some footsteps on there. Got a little bit of alligator arms, and, you know, Smith was right in time to, you know, come up with the deflection.
So, no, we got third and long here at 3rd and 8 from the 16. Jefferson Wentz is yet to be in a long third down conversion spot. Let's see how they respond here. The longest third down conversion has gone for 3rd and 6. They're going to need an additional 2 yards on this one. The Ince County defense here at Keister Field on the campus of Baser High School. Shotgun formation for the first time today. 3 receivers set. 2 of them are at the top of your screen. 1 setback. Mullins, got back into the rest in the huddle, going to throw, almost picked off, and it is! Interception Baser, across the 40, to the 45, to the 50, and shoestring tackle down in the Jefferson West field.
It is going nuts here in the press box right now, but it was a tip ball. Ball went in the air, tipped it back all of a sudden. Did you see 8 green jerseys going the other way? And, you know, how unfortunate for Jefferson West. I mean, they had an excellent drive going for them, and all of a sudden, you know, the field flips, and they got to go back and play defense again.
They're looking so good on the offensive side of the ball that you can't have errors against a strong Baser-Linwood team. So the Bobcats will take over on the offensive possession once again. This will be their second drive of the day, working left to right. They're in Jefferson West territory, right at about the 48-yard line. 1st and 10 from the 48, 5:08 left to go. Handoff will go to Potter, and Potter is met behind the line of scrimmage. He will stuff a big tackle by Jefferson West. You can credit the tackle to Jake Beard, the junior.
Yeah, one of the things you want to do, especially if you're on defense and you see that you have to go back on the field after an unfortunate, possession turn, is you want to get that big hit. You want to get something to keep that momentum, keep that, you know, that spirit up on your team's side.
Loss of yardage, 2nd and 13 for the Baser 49-yard line. Shotgun formation for the Bobcats. 2 receivers set. Murphy wants to throw long, going to throw about the 30, jumped up, and he wanted his brother in Ryan Murphy right at about the 35-yard line, but he threw into double coverage.
He just simply dropped that one. Had the catch as it was coming down, you know, gravity took control and took the ball out of his hands. But one of the things that I'm seeing so far on this series for the Bobcats is they're starting to take shots downfield. They want to go for the early knockout blow, something they've been doing the last few weeks. It's been taking a little bit, but, you know, they're going after it.
So it'll be 3rd and 13. Murphy rushing the backfield, going to throw near side. Ben Johnson, incomplete pass as it tips out of his hands right about the 34-yard line. Ben Johnson was able to get those big paws on it, but just wasn't able to bring it down. It'll bring up a big 4th down for the Bobcats.
Looks like we will see the punting unit come on the field.
And how about that? Drew Potter, the punter for this Bobcat team, going to come out for the first time today. Baser got a big score on their first drive. It went for about 60 yards. It's actually Ben Johnson will come out to punt. Johnson, not known for his punting abilities, as it's usually Potter in the backfield. Johnson, good, strong punt, gets it off the middle of the foot. It'll be taken about the 10-yard line. Across the 10, fighting far side, up to the 15, across the 16, to the 17, to the 20. Wrapped up and brought down, though. Showed good fight on that one is Logan Harris.
And that is the exact tonic that this Jeff West team needed. After getting that unfortunate turnover, get the quick 3 and out, get the offense back on the field. The offense has been driving, so it's not like they haven't been doing anything all day. It's just that, you know, that one turnover, you know, that's really bitten them hard. But, you know, they can come back, know they can run the offense, and, you know, hey, try and tie this ball game.
So let's see how Ian Mullins can respond to that interception on the previous drive. They come out shotgun formation once again. 3 receivers to the near side part of your screen. The handoff will go to Baranek. Baranek across the far side, maybe gets to the line of scrimmage before he's brought down. Strong tackle by the Baser defense. Of course, Jefferson City West trying to utilize some of their speed that Steve Johnson talked about earlier in the day. He said if they're going to have any hope, they're going to rely on the legs of their young sophomore core group. Not a senior-led team at all. They're young. They're trying to come and play the part of David in this one. Shotgun formation once again for the Tigers. 3 receivers set. Mullins looks near side, going to throw, has a receiver, and Baranek right across the middle, completed pass at the 25-yard line. Baranek never had a chance to get going as he was immediately tackled and brought down.
One of the things Jeff West wants to do is get those short intermediate passes. They know they can't challenge them deep. So if they get those, you know, dink and dunk passes, maybe it can open up, you know, for later passes and deeper passes in the ball game.
So it'll be third and five from about the 25-yard line. 3 minutes, 20 seconds left to go. First quarter of play, Bayshore-Linwood on top. Tigers driving. Still in their own territory, though. Shotgun formation is Mullins once again. Two receivers set to the near side. Mullins going to do a quarterback keeper. Far side wrapped up, still on his feet, trying to battle and taken down behind the line of scrimmage. Mullins never had a chance to get going as that one as he tried to turn the corner, and then his jersey got grabbed and then was pushed down.
Yeah, he had about 2 yards going up, and all of a sudden he's about 3 yards back, and that's just going to do that Baser defense, you know, doing great job of assignment football as compared to the first series where they were kind of just running all over the place. So quickly those mistakes were fixed.
So it'll be fourth and seven, and the punting unit will come out for the Bobcats as Brad Kaler will come out. Kaler on the punt. Good, strong punt. It'll bounce at the 50-yard line. Tanner Garber was back to receive it about the 40-yard line, but it bounces out of bounds at the Baser 45.
Now I'm looking at the clock, Aaron. 2:27 left to go. It looks like none of us, and I don't think any of these fans have really had a breather so far in this one.
Three and out last time for Colin Murphy. He's going to try and show that his offense can put up some points here in the first quarter playing. Last time, Jefferson West came to Keister Field. It was in a playoff action. They won that one by 3 touchdowns. Baser may be playing the revenge factor a little bit in this one. 2:27 left to go as the third drive for the Bobcats will start. One tight end set. Tanner Garber goes in motion. It'll be a handoff. Garber, it'll be a reverse. To the near side, it'll be Skyler Ross across the 45. Tries and finds a hole across the 40 to the 35. He might run for days, ladies and gentlemen. Across the 10 to the 5. Touchdown, Baser. Skyler Ross saw a hole and took it, and he didn't even look back.
Yeah, that was a great job. Yeah, once he saw that hole coming back on that backside reverse, took the football, found the open hole, and once again, great blocking, and they just ran it in for the score.
Steve Hopkins showing a little bit of those trick plays that he likes to use in times of needs. His team didn't necessarily need it in that part, but in an offense that looked stalled in their previous drive, they get a touchdown on a one-play drive.
Well, in a way, I kind of have to disagree with you, Aaron, on that one, because, you know, if you want to get that spark, if you want to really lay the hammer down on somebody early, you got to use a play like that. It really wake up your offense.
So it'll be 14-0 as Garrett Cayley will come on to kick. Zach Hebel will be the holder. Good strong hold by Hebel. The kick by Cayley is up and a line drive through the middle of the upright. It'll be good. So Baser leads this one 15-0. You're listening to Baser football on the home for high school sports. This is Baser Linwood football on the home for high school sports, HNVarsity.com. Back to the action with Aaron Berlin and Jonas Nordman. Welcome back to Keister Field. Baser Linwood on top here in this one. 2:15 left to go, first quarter of play. They've scored on two of their first three possessions here in this one, and Jefferson West slowly starting to see the wheels come off the truck.
Yeah, very, very early on. Had the great, excellent drive, and all of a sudden, you know, that tip interception that occurred deep in Bobcat territory. I mean, really just so far the biggest storyline, the biggest game changer in this one so far.
Tyler Ogden will come out once again, right at about the 30-yard line. Ogden, the right-footed kicker, takes this one about the 40, and we're underway. High end over end kick, going to be fielded right about the 15, across the 20, middle side, cuts back near side, still on his feet, across the 35 to the 40. Good strong return, but there is a flag on the play.
And
Logan Herring was the man on the return.
And it looks like Herring may have been called for the face mask, but from my vantage point, he had that stiff arm out, trying to get at least the shoulder pad, but all of a sudden looked like he may have grabbed part of the face mask.
So let's see what the initial call on the field is. As the umpires gather together right at about the 40-yard line, it'll be holding on the receiving team, so we'll back it up 5 yards. And I think they'll place the ball right at about the 25-yard line.
I guess you can't catch them all, right?
Exactly. Correction, it'll go technically for a 20-yard penalty as Herring worked his way all the way across the 40-yard line. So the Tigers starting with rough field position. Once again, still first quarter, 2:08 left to go. They find themselves down 15-0 off two big scoring plays by the Bobcats. Shotgun Mullins goes under center, strong I formation set. One receiver to the top of your screen. The handoff will go, and he's got a hole about as big as the Gulf of Mexico and Mick Moranek rushed all the way through it across to the 50-yard line.
A nice Gulf of Mexico reference.
And
nice.
You know,
love it.
I couldn't think of anything off the top of my
head. You know what it did look like?
What looks like a hole? Maybe the Gulf of Mexico, kind of? It's a half circle? I don't know.
It's okay, Aaron. From our vantage point, it did look like that hole was from the Gulf of Mexico.
I'm not necessarily good with words on my feet, which is bad for a broadcaster.
That's okay, though. I liked it. It was funny.
Big return by Mick Moranek works his team across the 46-yard line and will go for a 26-yard gain. I formation set once again for the Tigers. Mullins goes under center. Fake handoff. Still with the ball. Looks near side. Going to throw downfield. And it's intercepted by Baser. Intercepted right at the 30-yard line. So our sheet works his way across the 30. And the second interception of the day for the Bobcats.
Well, I mean, it was a good pass. I mean, he had great air on it. It was a spiral. Unfortunately, it just went to the other team.
Caleb Hiss was the man on the reception for the Bobcats. Just threw it to the wrong person on the field at the wrong time. Again, that's what's going to happen when you got a sophomore quarterback going against basically a senior defense.
And really, he had that one on target. Like I said, you know, he just threw it to the wrong guy. But, I mean, if that ball goes over just a little bit, you know, 2 feet more, you know, it's six.
Big turn of events right here. 1:34 left to go. We're still in the first quarter. Murphy will go into center, has one in the backfield, one tight end set, fullback. The handoff will go to Potter. Potter across the 35 in the middle of the field, squiggles his way to the 40-yard line before he's brought down. Drew Potter, the junior fullback on this team, has really been a focal point here early and often.
Yeah, one of the things, I'm looking at the scoreboard right now, 1:18 left to go, down 15-0. The Spatial Linwood offense moving very, very efficiently. You know, you hate to say that, like you said earlier, the wheels are coming off quick. With one more score, we could be looking at a ball game.
Shotgun formation, Ryan Murphy to the near side. Fake handoff. Murphy wants to throw, going to throw long, has his brother Ryan about the 30-yard line, jumps up and grabs it. Completed pass right at the 30-yard line. Ryan Murphy was going one-on-one with Dalton Dean, and he won that competition.
Yeah, right now, Ryan Murphy just, I mean, can we just put him in a Gatorade High School Player of the Year? I mean, he's just done an excellent job all season long. It's that same go route, you know, Murphy to Murphy down the field.
Well, Jefferson West was worried that they were going to play pitch and catch all day long, and that's what the Murphy twins have done. Strong eye formation set once again. Fake handle, or the handoff will go to Potter. Potter works for left side, maybe to the 30 or to the 27-yard line. If that, it might go for a gain of two. It was wrapped up pretty quickly before the play ever had a chance to develop. Baser ball threatening in Jefferson West territory. We're going to see a shotgun formation, this time out of Murphy. Murphy will be a quarterback keeper, left side, gets a block, works his way across the 30, and that's where the play is dead as he was quickly brought down. You can credit Logan Herring on the tackle, the senior.
Yeah, and recently in the last few weeks, I know against Turner and last week against Mill Valley, Colin Murphy was taking a lot of pressure and a lot of hits. But hopefully, you know, he can stay out of that trouble, especially with the game. If he gets closer, you know, he can stay out of harm's way.
And that'll be the final play of the first quarter play. After one, Baser leads this thing 15-0. Yosin in the home of high school sports on 810varsity.com. The weather may be cooling down, but you can still keep a hot tan. Stop into Bass Tanning anytime and keep that glow all year long. Bass Tanning right across the Sonic on 40 Highway. 724-2288, where the beds are cool and the tans are hot. Ladies and gentlemen, the Kansas City Command season tickets are now on sale for the 2012 Arena Football League season at Sprint Center. On sale now. Call 855-KC-ARENA. $5 footlong subs are back at Mr. Goodson's. 7 great subs to choose from. Come see what fresh really is at Mr. Goodson's. So after one quarter of play, Baser in complete control of this one. They looked good early and often, and it's been more the running game than the passing game so far.
Yeah, definitely. And like we said, you know, the Gulf of Mexico-sized holes that they're running through, it's been Baser running the football very, very efficiently, and, you know, completing passes very, very efficiently. But one of the other things that you're seeing is Jeff West really shooting themselves in the foot when they have the opportunity to get big plays. I mean, you know, if they even convert on that first series, it's possibly, you know, a
15-7, maybe even 8-7 ball game.
Baser Linwood has scored on two of their first three possessions. They are driving here in Tiger territory. Ball at about the 32. Murphy takes a shotgun pass, going to throw long, has his brother Ryan right in the end zone, and it was just overthrown. It'll go for an incomplete pass. Murphy maybe had a step, but his brother Colin threw it just long.
Yeah, you're definitely right about that. If he's maybe one and a half, maybe even two steps closer, that's an easy basket catch. But, you know, I do like how Baser Linwood was really just kind of going for the throw right here early on. Get that early, throw that early haymaker, trying to get my words right.
They went for the end zone, and it didn't quite work out. So they'll have 4th and 13. They're going to go for it. Murphy goes under center, looks left side, trying to get a coach from head coach Steve Hopkins, and they're going to call a timeout right there. Maybe they're just trying to see what the Tigers were going to do. Nick and Jake's Real Food, Honest Drink. Nick and Jake's, the proud title sponsor of 810varsity.com, located in Parkville in the Parkville Commons in the Norberland Park on 135th Street, or visit us online at nickandjakes.com. Once again, thank you for joining us here on 810varsity.com. My name, as always, is Aaron Berlin, but I'm joined, it seems I have a carousel effect going on here with my color analyst. This week I have Andrew Hammond, who I believe has not joined me since maybe the second week of play.
I think it was the first week when we did the season opener at Piper.
It was the season opener at Piper, and that might have been the closest game the Bobcats have had all year, as they have pretty much been on the driver's seat through these first six games.
Yeah, definitely. I mean, they are in the catbird seat of the Cal Valley, and, you know, with a win or two heading into, you know, the twilight of the season, hey, they're going to be right there in the when state playoffs start for 4A football.
11:56, Bobcats driving once again on the Tigers' 35-yard line. Shotgun formation. Murphy going to step back and throw. Has a receiver at the 20 at the 15-yard line. It's Ben Johnson, works his way across the 10 to the 8-yard line on the far side before he's pushed out of bounds.
And once again, I wish we had a telestrator. You know, Colin Murphy did an excellent job avoiding the pressure. Had a guy from Jeff West coming in, had picked up two blocks, had time to throw, collect himself, gets that throw right down the field.
So they needed 13 yards, and they got it on the fourth down conversion. So it'll be first and goal from the 6-yard line. Strong eye formation set for the Bobcats. Pitch and toss to Potter. Potter works far side across the 5 to the 4 to the 3 before he works his way maybe to the 2-yard line after the tackle. It'll pin where they swap the ball where his knee touched.
It looks like I want to say I'm the best vantage point, but it looks like they will spot it at around the 2-yard line.
So it'll be second and goal and very short yardage. Ball right at the 2-yard line. 11:43 left to go. Second quarter of play. Bobcats in control, 15-0. High formation set is Murphy. Hand off to Potter right up the middle. Pushes the pile forward, and he got the touchdown. Touchdown, Bobcats. They lead this one now, 21-0, after the third score and the second score by Drew Potter.
Yeah, one of the things that I'm thinking to myself, and of course you've been following this team all season long, is it seems like the first and second quarters are the same thing. It's just there's a different team in the jersey every single week. I mean, they don't deviate from what they do. They're strong, efficient on offense, and they just put points up on the board.
And they do it very efficiently. The second quarter of play has been Baser's quarter. They scored 20 last week against Mill Valley. They get an early score here in the second quarter today to push the lead to 21-0. Kaylee comes on to kick. It'll be a high snap. Gets it down to Zach Hevel. High kick by Kaylee up and over. It's a high end over and kick, and it goes for an extra point. So 11:39 left to go. Second quarter of play. Bobcats in complete control of this one. They lead it 22-0 here in the home of high school sports, 810varsity.com. This is Baser Linwood football on the home for high school sports, 810varsity.com. And back to the action with Aaron Berlin and Jonas Nordman. Welcome back here to Keister Field on 810varsity.com. Number 8 in the 810varsity.com top 25 poll presented to you by the Kansas City Command. Bobcats in control on this one. They're in the driver's seat, and they haven't quite looked back on this Cadillac of a car that they call Colin Murphy. 22-0 as Tyler Ogden comes out for his third kick of the day. He's gotten a lot of work on that right foot.
So you're going to call him a Cadillac?
I might. It seems to be that's kind of what they're driving right now is a Cadillac car. Ogden, high kick. They'll rush back. It'll be fielded at the 5 by Herring. Herring across the 15 to the 20. Gets a blocker in the end zone. Well, not in the end zone, about the 20-yard line. Works his way across the 25 and squirts his way to the 17.
Yeah, right now, if you're Jefferson West, you need points on the board. I don't care what it is. You are, you know, down 22-0, 11:33 left to go in the half. You are automatically in four-down territory at this point. You got to get some type of points. You got to get some type of
momentum and some type of spark in your team. I mean, they're already seeing the score. They already have the David versus Goliath feel to it. So, you know, you want to keep their spirits up and try and get some points on the board and make this a respectable game.
Ian Mullins, a sophomore quarterback, trying to rally the troops once again. Shotgun formation, one receiver to the near side part of your screen. Handoff will go to Herring. Herring works left side across the 30 to the 34. Before the play, he was blown dead there. Herring has been their most efficient running back so far today, but the field position for the Tigers has been what's hurting them. They're mostly starting their drives in around the 20-yard line, maybe the 25.
Yeah, and really they had that benefit early on in the game with the kick going out of bounds, and they took it to around the 30-yard line. But other than that, like you said, they've been in the 20, and I believe this one started, the 26-yard line or so.
So it'll go for a 6-yard gain. Second and four, Mullins under center. The handoff will go to Herring. Herring works his way across the 40. It'll be enough for a first down on the 4-yard gain. Good pickup, as the running game has really been there so far for the Tigers. The passing game has yielded two interceptions on their first three drives. They had one punt, but overall their drives have gone and they've ate up some of the clock, which they just need to find a way to stop this senior-led offense by Baser.
Yeah, definitely. I mean, if they were putting up points in running the clock, then, you know, they wouldn't be in the situation where it's down 22-0. But, you know, the first interception was kind of a fluke, kind of a funky interception. But the second one, you know, was just bad timing on that pass.
Mullins breaks the huddle and goes under center here, under his big center and Branson Vaught, fellow sophomore. They start seven sophomores on the offensive side of the ball. Handoff will go to Herring. Herring works left side across the 40, maybe to the 41, where he gets a big hit. It was almost kind of like a helmet-to-helmet hit, as Herring never had a chance to let that play develop.
Yeah, and one of the things you see from this Basin Linwood team, they will hit hard, they will hit with conviction. That's what you want in football. You want somebody hitting with a little anger.
So it'll be enough for a gain of two here with 10-12 left to go. Second quarter of play. Bobcats on top, 22-0. Tigers driving here, though, as they're still in their own field of play, trying to get to Bobcat territory for just the second time. Ball right at about the 40-yard line. Mullins under center. Baser shows blitz. Handoff will go near side, working his way across the 40 to the 44, trying to push that pile forward is the big man and Logan Herring. Herring has shielded the majority of the attack or of the handoffs here today, as they have been kind of nervous, to say the least, when they want to throw the ball.
Yeah, I mean, they've been a little hesitant, and that's something that, you know, especially with a sophomore quarterback in an atmosphere, playing a varsity-laden team like this, or a senior-laden team like this, you know, you are going to be a little leery about that, and it has cost them with two interceptions.
So it'll be third and six, big third down, as it looks like we might have a timeout on the field. It'll be a timeout for Baser. Hey, Bobcat fans, check out the game night special from Simple Simons, a free media medium one-topping pizza with a purchase of a large specialty. Yes, a free medium one-topping pizza from Simple Simons with a large specialty. Carry out only. Special only good on Bobcat football game nights. Call 913-724-4141 and place your order now, or visit them at BaserSimpleSimons.com. Play KC's most popular four-man scramble, over 7,800 yards. It's the Monster Mash at Dubs Red October 7th. Call Dubs Red Golf Club at 913-324-5005 or visit them at DubsRedGolfClub.com. Tigers driving here in the second quarter of play, trying to find their way on the scoreboard and eliminate that big goose egg that finds its way there now. 9:20 left to go, second quarter, as Mullins breaks the huddle after the Baser timeout.
Yeah, one of the things I want to see, if they keep running the football, that's something they've done very, very well. They surprised me on the first series by running the football. Let's see what they do here.
I formation set. The receiver is at the top of the screen as this play is blown dead before the handoff to Herring ever had a chance.
Looks like we have a penalty flag on the far side of the field.
It'll be on the defensive side of the ball, so it'll go against the Bobcat. That should be enough to almost give him the first down. If not, it'll make it just shy.
Yep. Looks like just shy. Oh, you could get a mark on that, but they
that looks like a first down to me.
That looks like a first, yeah.
Ball's placed right on the left hash mark at about the 48-yard line, and there we go. We have the signal that we'll go for a first down.
Yeah, and that was a short third and six right there, but if you're Baser Linwood, that's something that, even though you're up 22-0, that's something you really don't want.
Hurry up offense here by Mullins as he's quick to go under center. Baser's still scrambling to try to get their personnel on the field. The handoff will go to Herring right up the middle, and we got a flag thrown by the back judge, who is right at about the 30-yard line. Let's see what the development on the play is. It might have been too many men on the field for the Bobcats. And yeah. Skyler Ross was still trying to scamper off.
That was a pretty smart maneuver. You know, try and get some yards, even though you can't get through the air through the ground as well. Try forcing some penalties.
If you're the Tigers, you got to find some kind of combination that works for you.
It's not classy, but hey, whatever gets the job done.
And it looks like this is going against Baser, as they'll move the ball all the way up to the 42-yard line. It's really closer to the 41, as the front side part of the ball is about 2 inches away from the left hash mark. 9:10 left to go, second quarter of play. Baser leads this one 22-0. Play is able to start here as the play clock starts to roll. Mullins under center, quick snap camp. Handoff will go to Baronic. Baronic met right at the line of scrimmage. He wanted to get to the left side of the field, but never had a chance. Nick Baronic, the senior, the main fullback, or the main running back option, Logan Herring, is the fullback. Those two have seen quite the handoffs here today. Tigers struggling to get any kind of momentum going, as two penalties have pushed them into Baser territory. So they'll start this play. It'll be second and two from about the 43-yard line. The 43-yard line of the Bobcats. Send a man in motion as Herring. Herring works left side. Quarterback's going to throw now. Mullen still on his feet, scrambling, cuffed. The 45 to the 42 before he's pushed out of bounds. He maybe got back to the initial line of scrimmage. The pocket collapsed in a hurry there that time.
And looks like we're going to get a spot on this one. Waiting on it. Looks like he may have actually lost a yard. Because it was a lot closer, but it's going to be a long one instead of just a third and short one.
So it'll be about third and inches as they need to get to the 41-yard line. The back of the ball is touching the left hash mark of the 42-yard line. Mullins quick to go under center once again. Two strong I formation as the handoff will go to Baranek. Baranek works his way up, and he's got enough for the first down as he got a couple of yards. He needed about a half an inch, and he goes for two or three. So it's good news for the Tigers as they keep this drive alive. This is the longest drive we've seen so far, as two of their three drives have ended in a turnover.
Yeah, one of the things I do want to see Baser Linwood do on defense is sub quickly. I mean, they're getting to the line. Once they get out of the huddle, they are sprinting to the line. You know, they caught them on that substitution infraction. So if you're Baser Linwood, you want to get those guys, get the play in, get the guys you need, and get out.
Jefferson West starting to pick up the tempo of this game as they didn't like the way it was going. Mullins talks with Nick Baranek in the backfield. Baranek is right at about the 46-yard line. Sends a man in motion as Herring from the top of your screen. Fake handoff is be a kind of a misdirection handoff, if you want to call it that. It was a fake handoff to Nick Baranek in the backfield. Logan Herring was coming from the top of your screen. Ended up going to Herring, but that play, it didn't develop. It never had a chance.
Well, it was that end around, but when you're going up against defense that likes to put pressure, especially on the front line, especially on the offensive line, running an end around is the last thing you want to do.
7:30 left to go in the second quarter. Ball right at about the Baser-Linwood 43-yard line. They need to get to the 30 of Baser for a first down. That'll be second and 12. Handoff will go, and he's wrapped up and brought down. Sack for Baser. Big time as Drew Potter busted through on the blitz and was able to get to Dylan Hewitt. Correction, Nick Cheney in on the tackle. Drew Potter with the assist. Skyler Ross will sub in and out as Garrett Keeley will also come out for the Bobcat defense.
Yeah, one of the things that Baser Linwood has especially done all season long is once somebody has gotten momentum, they've easily taken it away. And all of a sudden, you know, you're third down, in enemy territory. Now it's a huge third down situation, third down and long.
Third and 15, then they get the 30-yard line of Baser. It'll be a pitch to Baranek on the left side part of your screen. Baranek, speedy as he is, across the 40 to the 45. I don't think he quite got to the 30-yard line, but it's going to be close. He worked to the left side part of your screen, turned on the jets about the 40-yard line, and scooted his way across the 35 to about the 33 is where they're going to blow it dead.
Looks like actually the 34, so, you know, fourth and long situation. Yeah, like we said at the beginning of this drive, it seems like a long time ago with all the penalties and infractions and stuff. You know, you are in four down territory, so you have to convert here. If you have any chance, of staying in this ball game.
Big fourth down right here for the sophomore quarterback and Ian Mullins. He needs to come up big on this one. It'll be fourth and four from the 34-yard line. They need to get to the 30-yard line of Baser. Baser putting everyone up on the line here in this one. As the play is blown dead before it ever got started, I think we got a false start on the offense. Correction. They're going to call a timeout. Steve Johnson wanted to see what kind of defensive package the Tigers were going to throw at him.
Yeah, I mean, you have a variety of options here. You could go through the air with a quick slant. You could just run the ball. I mean, Aaron, in this situation, what would you do?
Sorry, what was that again?
All right, I was saying, you know, I'm going to give you the analyst job right here. Fourth and four, you're down 22. You've been trying to throw, and you haven't done it as successful, but, you know, you've been running the football all game long.
I think you have to put confidence into your quarterback and allow him to keep slinging the ball. Threw for over 300 yards last week, so he can obviously throw the ball, but he's going up against a whole other animal in the Bobcat defense.
Yeah, one of the things I'd like to do, and you know, the offensive line has been giving him great protection as far as passing goes. He's had it all day, and when he's had the scramble, he has great quarterback awareness. So one of the things that you'd really want to see, possibly a play-action rollout type thing where he has options, he can run, or he has guys leaking out, especially like a tight end or so, you know, for just to run a quick 5 yard out.
Under 6 minutes of play left to go here in the second quarter. This drive started with 9 minutes left on the clock, so it's a tribute to how Jefferson West has decided to use their clock management. Strong eye formation set, fourth and four from the left hash mark. They need to get to the 30-yard line of the Bobcats. Mullins drop back, five-step drop, going to throw on the run, has a completed receiver right at about the 25-yard line. Works his way to the 26. He initially caught it at the 28, and they'll go for a Jefferson West first down. And how about that never say die kind of saying right there by Ian Mullins?
Yeah, Ian Mullins, he, you know, we talked about the awareness that he had. I mean, it seems like once he basically, you know, started that play, he was already sprinting out, even though it wasn't a design rollout. He already knew he was going to get pressure, had guys leaking out to the side, and like we said, and, you know, just, you know, threw a bullet right down the middle of the field.
Ball right on the left hash mark is another strong eye formation set for the Tigers. Mullins under center, two receivers set to the near side. Handoff will go to Herring, backfield, works his way across the 37, maybe wiggles his way to the 36 as he dove down trying to go for the extra yardage. It'll go for a second and 11. It'll initially go for a loss in yards. I thought he got back to the line of scrimmage, but it turns out he didn't. Clock continuing to roll here in the second quarter of play as the Tigers need to hurry this one up. It would be wise of them to try and get a score right before halftime and keep this Baser offense off the field. I formation set once again as Mullins goes under center, barks out the order. It'll be a pitch play. Baranek on the left side. Baranek gets a blocker across the 25, still on his feet across the 20, to the 10, the 5, touchdown Jefferson West. He tightroped the sideline and was able to stay in and finally gets the Tigers on the board as they're able to replace that goose egg with a 6.
Yeah, and that was great job by Brannick by staying in, keeping his legs moving, even though he was getting contact going down the sideline. Like you say, he did that nice little tightrope. You know, they get the touchdown. Now, you know, they're going to send the field goal unit out. So, like you said, if they can just get points on the board, keep the confidence up going into halftime, and it's not like they, you know, haven't been able to drive on this team all day. It's their second successful drive.
Kaler comes on to kick, and it'll be a high, good kick. As, they might have said that one went left side.
They gave it to him.
Never mind. My bad eyes at age 22. You know, they say you get that 22nd birthday, and that's really where it all starts to go downhill. My birthday was last week, and it seems like it all kind of has gone downhill. My eyesight's slowly starting to fade.
Oh, come on.
I had a 20/20 eyesight for a long time, and I've never needed glasses. But I'll tell you what, I get up in these high school press boxes, and it's like I'm an old man.
Oh, you know, don't get me started on it. Because my birthday was in April, and my eyesight is perfectly fine.
Well, you're really feeling old, aren't you?
You know, I am. Some days I just wonder, you know, when am I getting closer to a nursing home?
The Tigers are going up against a couple of old men by high school standards, and that's the senior squad by the Bobcats. They finally got on the board with 4:26 left to go. It's a 22-7 lead. It's about a 16-point deficit for the Tigers, but it's what you like to see right before the break. The offense, which had successful drives early and often, finally able to finish one out. We hadn't seen it. We'd seen two interception thrown earlier in the game. We saw one that kind of bobbled around on the base of the defense. It was a tipped interception. Nothing Ian Mullins could do on that one, but then he threw another one to Zach Smith right at about the 35-yard line. So it's nice to see him finally get some confidence moving forward. Tigers will come on to kick. It'll be a squib kick. It'll bounce at the 35, and the Bobcats will fall on it right on the far side of the 25-yard line. So that's where Colin Murphy will come out once again, the fifth drive of the day for the Bobcats. They're going to try and get another touchdown on the board right before the halftime, and you can never say never with this offensive unit. It's averaging around 42 points per game. It's been one of the most efficient offenses I've seen in a long time. They got two strong receivers in Ben Johnson as well as Ryan Murphy. You got two strong running, or three strong running backs, really, with Skyler Ross, Jesse Hiss, as well as Drew Potter. We'll see a shotgun formation for the first play of the drive that will start right at the Bobcat 25-yard line. Quarterback keeper is Murphy. Murphy angles near side across the 35 to the 40. Still on his feet, and he's pushed out of bounds right at the 50-yard line by Nick Baranek.
And really got away with a hold right there. But, you know, looking at the clock, you got 4:16 left to go. I mean, this is, like you said, this is plenty of time for this offense to get some points on the board. And, you know, it seems like they can do whatever they want in the game plan. Steve Hopkins can open up the playbook, and they can just run any type of play and score.
Ball right on the left side hash mark on the near side. Shotgun formation is Murphy once again. Tyner Garver is right at the top of your screen. The handoff will go to Skyler Ross, who angles left side, and is going to be marked by forward progress as he was met by three or four defenders right when he got to the line of scrimmage. 4:04 left to go as we tick under 4 minutes left to go here in the second quarter of play. The Tigers just punched in their first touchdown drive of the day on a big, strong run. So with that, it'll be second and 13. Ball right at the 46-yard line. Middle of the field right in front of the yellow Bobcat. Shotgun formation is Murphy. Murphy looks near side, standing in the pocket, going to throw, has a receiver, and Ben Johnson completed pass right at the 40-yard line. Johnson caught it and then squirted his way across the 40 to the 39, and he's in Tiger territory.
Yeah, one of the things you have to like about Ben Johnson is that the guy can catch it. He can catch it in the slot as a receiver, tight end, and, you know, he's even gone into the running back spot. So, you know, he's a jack of all trades, I like to say.
It'll go for a Bobcat first down. Clock running, 3:35 left to go. Ball at the 40-yard line. Murphy going to sit back and throw. Throws far side. Going to throw it up for his brother and Ryan Murphy. And a flag quickly thrown out on the incompleted pass.
Hey, if you're Jefferson West, that's the last thing you want. In a way, you just kind of want him to, you know, at least try and go for the ball right there. But, you know, that height advantage, that has really killed a lot of teams. So
penalty marker was thrown by the back judge right about the 5-yard line. He had a good close-up view of the coverage between Mick Baranek as well as Ryan Murphy. Oh, and they're going to call it offensive pass interference. I was figuring it might have gone the other way around, but without instant replay at the high school level, what are you going to do?
Yeah, I'd really love to go and see that replay, and the Base are faithful, not happy about that. It looked like they were both going at it, but normally in that situation, they always will call that defensive pass interference.
It'll be a big penalty for the Bobcats, who are trying to get some momentum, maybe a little bit more momentum going into halftime. 3:26 left to go, 22-7 lead for the Bobcats. It's a commanding lead, but the Tigers just punched one in. Colin Murphy and friends are trying to get back into the end zone for the fourth time here today. Shotgun formation. Murphy rolls out near side. Going to look. Going to throw near side. Backing up is Ryan Murphy. Completed pass right at the 32 before he falls out of bounds at the 31.
No pass interference there, but good job being physical. Once he caught the ball, that yards after catch, he really could have got pushed out of bounds, but, you know, gained those, you know, extra few yards.
It'll be a 24-yard completion by Murphy to Murphy. 22-7, 3 minutes, 20 seconds left to go. Second quarter of play right before halftime. Shotgun formation for the Bobcats once again. Fake handoff will go. It'll be a quarterback keeper. Murphy rolls out far side, looking downfield. Going to throw. Ben Johnson right at the 30-yard line for a completed pass. And he keeps the yards after the run or yards after the catch and works his way to the 16-yard line. So with that, it'll go for a Bobcat first down. Colin Murphy keeping the composure when the pocket seems to start to collapse and able to find his receivers. Whether it's been Ben Johnson or Ryan Murphy, he's been able to be spot on all afternoon.
Well, when your receivers are 5 inches taller than the D-backs, yeah, you can get away with it.
Murphy goes under the big center, and Josh Barnes once again. Pitch will go to Potter. Potter angles near side, finds a hole across the 15 to the 12 to the 11 before he's tackled and brought down by Drake Bird, the junior linebacker. Bird was able to stop the big 6'4", 217-pound frame of Potter. And with that, the clock still continuing to roll here as we are about 2 minutes and 30 seconds left to go. Tigers need a big turnover here in the red zone. They're going to keep any of that momentum they just gained. One tight end set. Offset eye formation of the Bobcats. Pitch will go to Potter. Potter in the backfield trying to work his way back to the line of scrimmage before he's tackled. It might go for a loss of one. Potter angled near side, but the hole that he wanted quickly collapsed and he was met by a handful of Tiger defenders. Drake Bird in there on the tackle. Clock ticking under 2 minutes of play. You think head coach Steve Johnson of the Tigers is just trying to keep his defense settled?
Yeah, I think he's just trying to, you know, at least get a big stand or, you know, hold him to three.
Murphy calls his own number across the 11 on the far side. Maybe gets to the 10-yard line. He needed to get to the 8. I think he might just be short on the quarterback keeper.
Yeah, one of the things that you said, you know, one of the things that Steve Johnson wants to do, if he can hold them right here, that's a huge momentum swing because this has probably been, you know, really their most efficient drive of the game. I know we keep saying that, but if they can stop them right here off of baseline, like I said, most efficient drive so far, great momentum swing going into the last, you know, minute of the half.
Fourth and one with a minute 15 left to go on the clock. Colin Murphy rallies the troops, goes up to the line of scrimmage, looks to the near side to get the call from head coach Steve Hopkins.
I'm going to go with the fade route.
Strong eye formation set once again. Murphy keeps it. Play action pass throw in the end zone. Caught by Ben Johnson. Ben Johnson on the far side was able to get a little bit of a space and fell down when he caught it.
And the green and gold fans are clapping each other high
five. Ladies and gentlemen, we got almost 30 points on the board, and we still got fireworks here at Keister Field.
I mean, these fans are really into it, and really on that play, that's just, it seems like this team can just do no wrong at this point right now. I mean, they're just moving the ball efficiently. Third down, first down, fourth down, doesn't even matter. They're scoring.
Follow 810varsity.com on Facebook and Twitter. The rest of the season, we'll choose a weekly winner for $50 gift certificates to Best Buy and more. Follow 810varsity on Facebook or Twitter today. The offensive unit will stay out on the floor for the Bobcats as they might go for a two-point conversion. We have a timeout on the field. It'll be a Baser timeout.
I believe it's going to be, I think they say Jeff West.
Jefferson West, never mind, as I am corrected once again. Bobcat fans, check out the game night special from Simple Simons, a free medium one-topping pizza with the purchase of a large specialty. Yes, a free medium pizza from Simple Simons with a large specialty. Carry out only. Special only good on Bobcat football game nights. Call 913-724-4141 and place your order now, or visit us at BaserSimpleSimons.com.
Doesn't that sound good?
It does. It sounds nice and toasty here on a cold October night.
Yeah, we were trying to go back there last week, and it was closed, but now it's open, so hey, we're right down the street.
We might have a better chance to get in there. Bobcats on top of this one. They find themselves with a 28-7 lead just before halftime. My name, Aaron Berlin. I'm joined alongside by my color analyst and Andrew Hammond here this evening. The keys were fully given to Colin Murphy at the start of the season. He's done no wrong with them as he's driven this Cadillac of an offense of the 4A standards. First round of district play here. Two-point conversion up, and let's go. Murphy going to throw back to the end zone. It's going to go incomplete as he wanted to get a fade route to Tanner Garber.
Yeah, tried to go over the top with that one, but actually it was dropped. Could have had an interception for Jefferson West, but, you know, 58 seconds left, 28-7, Baser Linwood. And, you know, one of the things that I talked about in the opening, point differential. Point differential is one of the key tiebreakers, in, according to the Kansas State High School Athletic Association, when it comes to district play. So the more you score, if you go into a tiebreaker situation, that is what really settles everything. So the more you score, you're good. For Jeff West, they're going to need some points if this game does continue to be as big of a gap as it is.
Nick Baranek and Logan Herring are back to return for the Tigers once again. Tyler Ogden comes on for the fourth time here this evening. Strong right-handed kick. It'll be a low one as Jordan Herring will feel it on the far side. He bobbled it. He dropped it right at the 25. Picks it up, still on his feet across the 35, almost to the 40-yard line of Tiger territory, but I think the play went dead at 38. So with 52 seconds left to go on the clock here in the second quarter, Ian Mullins comes out to lead the troops. Maybe a little bit of a one-minute offense here, and maybe we can see him sling some passes all over here on the Bobcat field.
Yeah, it's 28-7, so you know you could see that, or you could see the fact that just avoid disaster. You cannot have that, you know, an interception, fumble. If you can just go into this last 52 seconds unscathed, you know, they'll definitely take that.
Disaster has struck twice already, and it's coming in the form of two interceptions. Shotgun formation, three receivers set to the near side. High snap is Mullins, and it's batted down to the backfield by Drew Potter as he kind of thrusts his arms in excitement on that one. Potter came on the blitz and was met right in the face of Ian Mullins, who wanted to throw to the far side part of the field.
So fans are feeling it right now.
So it'll be second and 10. It took 2 seconds off the clock. 50 seconds left to go. Second quarter of play. Ian Mullins breaks the huddle for the Tigers. Two receivers set to the near side. The receiver to the top of your screen. Mullins, shotgun formation. High snap once again. Crowds it with the right hand. Got to keep it himself across the 40 to the 45. Almost in the Baster territory where he's knocked down at the 49.
That looks like, from my vantage point, that will be a first down.
He needed to get to the 48-yard line. It looks like they're going to spot it kind of towards the 49. It would be a generous first down, if you want to call it that.
Oh, come on, you got to give me something on that one. My side isn't as bad as yours, sir.
So to move the chains once again. Clock still rolling. Under 40 seconds left to go. Four receiver snap. Belt high snap. Mullins looks to throw. Far side has a receiver right at the 40. Across the 35 to the 30 before he's pushed out of bounds. It's Mick Barrerick on the reception.
That was completed to Baranek.
And this is where the hurry-up offense goes into hand.
Baranek was on the reception. He worked his way to the 30-yard line. Clock still ticking here with 29 seconds left to go.
And basically need to stop standing around. This ball can snap any second.
Four receivers set once again. Shotgun formation. Mullins calls out the signal. Belt high snap. Going to keep it himself across the 30. Squirrels his way to the 29. Never had a chance to get that play going. He saw a hole, but the Baster defense quickly collapsed on it.
And the final timeout has been taken by Jefferson West.
And how about that? With 19 seconds left to go, Jefferson West calls their final timeout of the first quarter of play. They need a big score here. They're going to stay in contention here at Kaiser Field with this big, strong Bobcat defense and offense.
Yeah, it was really with no timeouts, 19 seconds left to go. You have the opportunity of throwing, you know, to try and get something down the middle, maybe try and take a shot at the end zone, but you definitely want to get it. I'd say inside the 15, and make sure you get out of bounds. And if you have time, maybe one more play, possibly a field goal right here. But right now, the key for Jefferson West, like we said, with 19 seconds left to go, they have to get any type of points, any type of positive momentum. Points will have to do right here.
Let's pause a quick second for station identification. You're listening to the home of high school sports.
Without oil.
This is Baser Linwood football on the home for high school sports, hnvarsity.com. And back to the action with Aaron Berlin and Jonas Nordman. 19 seconds left to go on the clock here in the second quarter of play. Tigers driving in Baser territory. Mullins ball on the Bobcat 30-yard line. High snap on the shotgun formation. And the play is blown dead as we have a penalty marker on the field. It was thrown by the side judge, and it'll be encroachment on the defense. It'll be a 5-yard penalty, so it'll move them even closer to the Bobcat end zone. It'll get them within the 25-yard line. They'll spot it at the 23 on the left hash mark.
And now remember when I said get inside the 15? Now try and get it inside the 10. Get out of bounds and see what you can do.
18 seconds left to go on the clock. Ian Mullins started this drive right at about the 35-yard line
looks
with
like
52 seconds left to go on the clock.
It looks like we may be resetting the clock here. Yet back at 19 seconds.
And it is at 19 seconds. It was initially at 18. Four receivers set for the Tigers. One man in the backfield along with Mullins. Shotgun formation. Four down linemen for the Bobcats. High snap once again. Mullins corrals it. Pocket collapse and still on his feet. Going to throw far side. Nick Burrell coming to reception at the 15-yard line and hit ferociously out of bounds.
And he was not in bounds on that play. It looks like the referees won't give him that extra contact, but they will be moving it up here. The clock is running.
12 seconds left to go on the play clock. They're going to reset the down markers. Ball right at the 15-yard line. He's going to go under center. He's going to spike it really quickly to stop the clock with 9 seconds. So they might have time for one or two more plays. Head coach Steve Johnson said before the game, we're going to see a lot of intermediate routes by the Tiger offense, and that is what we've seen. We've seen when Ian Mullins dropped back in the past, he's not looking for a big 25-plus yard throw. He's looking more in the round of 10 to 15 yards.
Yeah, and even right here, you can get a quick 5 yard out. You know, there's not much coverage over here on the weak side.
Mullins breaks the huddle once again. Shotgun formation. High snap. Corrals it. Looks near side. Going to throw. Hit as he throws. Into the end zone. Intercepted.
He's got plenty of room.
Line. He's got plenty of room. And on that one, it was Caleb Hiss on the reception about 2 yards deep into the Bobcat end zone. That's the third interception today by the Bobcat defense. And that will end the second quarter of play. So with that, we got a halftime. Bobcats lead this one 28-7. They have 3 interceptions in the first half alone.
Ladies and gentlemen, you're looking at 130 future Bobcat Dazzlers. Tonight, ladies and gentlemen, your future Bobcat Dazzlers and your Bobcat Dazzlers will be dancing to Glee Mix. Ladies, your music's on!
I'd like to take over Glee Club.
Gentlemen, somebody's going to walk home with $292 tonight. Pull out your ticket. Here we go. Here's your number.
165133.
One up here to the press box will get your money. We want to thank everybody for sponsoring the Junior Ambassadors. There goes the lucky one.
Thank you.
Ladies and gentlemen, your Basil Linwood High School marching band. How about a great big hand for them?
Woo!
Ladies and gentlemen, you might check your pockets. Got a set of keys to a Ford, got a guitar on it. Went up to the announcer's booth and I'll let you describe the rest.
Sounds like a hillbilly to me.
We found the car by turning the arm on. You don't find your keys, it'll be the last one left in the parking lot.
On the tow truck.
Welcome back to 810varsity.com's coverage of East Ringland Wood Football here on the home for high school sports, 810varsity.com. 28 points are up on the board for the East Ringland Wood Bobcats after the first half of play. 7 reside for the Jefferson West here in the first round of district play. My name is Aaron Berlin, joined alongside by my color analyst, Andrew Hammond. Andrew, what are some of the things you look at that first half of play and you kind of look back on and say that was the turning point?
It has to be that tipped interception in the first half. I mean, Jefferson West was driving, probably had their best drive of the season as we have a little Johnny Cash to start the second half, 1:47 left to go in halftime. But that tipped interception, it was 8-0 in the ball game. And Jefferson West probably had one of their best drives of the season so far in this ball game, had the tipped interception, took it back. Basin Linwood turned into 15 points total after they scored the touchdown. And then the second interception in the red zone to end the half, that was, I believe, on a fourth down, had a shot at the end zone, intercepted a few yards away from the end zone. So it was just some bad luck for Jeff West, but for Basin Linwood, it's been the same thing all season long. We talked about this on our way back up from the concession stand. It's a team that doesn't deviate away from anything. They keep the same game plan, and they execute it to perfection. And those are the keys of a championship-caliber ball club.
The Bobcats scored on 4 of their 5 possessions in the first half of play. It'll be Tiger ball, though, when we return, as the captains meet at midfield right now. Ordering GoodSense is now quick and easy with GoodSense online ordering. Just log on to MrGoodSense.com and place your order today. The Kansas City Command season tickets for the 2012 Arena Football League season at Sprint Center are on sale now. Call 855-KC-ARENA. Bobcats in control here before we kick off the second half of play. 28-7, they find themselves on top here on the home for high school sports, 810varsity.com. This is Baser Linwood football on the home for high school sports, 810varsity.com. And back to the action with Aaron Berlin and Jonas Nordman. Andrew, I'm sorry the IDs that we play in between games do not feature your name here today. You're usually not my color analyst. Andrew Hammond sitting in for Jonas Nordman, who is taking his second week off. I wish I could take
What's
my job off
that?
Every week. You know, it's not being committed, and that's a major problem. I have a problem with that.
You know, I'm glad I can do these games with you. I know we have a lot of history of doing radio and doing games together, so it's just like two old friends just going back at it.
Jefferson West trying to stop a three-game losing streak. They find themselves down here in the second half. They got a long way to go. Head coach Steve Johnson said his team was undersized and they're going to have to rely on their speed before the game. They've used their speed, but they also have shot themselves in the foot, tallying three interceptions in the first half of play. Bobcats will come out to kick here to start off the second quarter of play. They receive the ball for the first half here in this football game. Back to receive for the Tigers will be Mick Baranek as well as Logan Herring. Herring is on the left side, top part of your screen. Baranek is on the near side. Baranek standing right at about the 12-yard line. Herring is back at about really the 10 or the 11. Tyler Ogden's kick, it's a high one, and it's good. Herring has to backpedal to get it. He'll take it up the 7, angles left side, back, cuts back middle, still on his feet, up to the 27, to the 28, and that's where we're going to see Ian Mullins come out for the first drive of the second half. Mullins threw three picks in the first half, so it's going to see what his mind is thinking as we start things off.
Well, one of the things that, you know, being an ex-quarterback, albeit, you know, sitting the bench, but being an ex-quarterback and learning from your mistakes, one of the things that you want to do right now, with it being 28-7 in the ball game, you've thrown three interceptions, keep your confidence up, keep throwing. It's like a, you know, a bad shooter in basketball. Just keep shooting the ball. You're going to get that groove back.
Mullins breaks the huddle, and we're going to see him go under center. Five down linemen for the Bobcats. Handoff will go left side. Angling left is Logan Herring, the senior ball carrier. Herring took the majority of the carries in the first half. He split them with Mick Baranek.
Yeah, one of the things that Baranek, especially running the offense, they did an excellent job in the first half. Running the football and really started out in that first series just moving the ball very efficiently. It seemed like they were just powering the ball down the field, but once they put it in the air, they were struggling.
The run by Herring will go for a gain of 3 yards. 11:27 left to go. Tigers still in their own territory, working left to right. Mullins goes under center once again. The pitch will go to Moranic in the backfield, and he stuffed before he ever had a chance. The pitch was 5 yards deep on the left side, and he was quickly wrapped up and brought down.
Yeah, one of the things that Basil Linwood did on that play is, I wish we had the advent instant replay. I mean, they have four or five, even six guys just moving on that, you know, at the line of scrimmage, just trying to disrupt, trying to, you know, throw them off their game a little bit, throwing Jefferson West off their game a little bit, and they did an excellent job, snuffing out that run.
So it'll be third and long with 10:48 left to go, third quarter of play. Bobcat defense trying to hold for the first drive here in the second half. It'd be a big momentum killer for the Bobcats to just get a stop here. The Tigers really needing to put something. Two receivers near side part of your screen, offset I formation set. Mullins goes under center. It's three-step drop, wants to throw, going to throw long, batted down before he ever had a chance to release the ball. Drew Potter was in there on the rush and got his hand up there. That's his third tipped pass of the day.
Yeah, I mean, he did an excellent job in the first half. Once again, they're disguising the blitzes, especially, you know, with a sophomore quarterback at this point, you know. That's the last thing he wants to see is, where is the blitz coming from this time? Where is it going to come from this time? Are they going to send three? Are they going to send four? Are they coming from the left, right, or straight up the middle? Basil Lim would do an excellent job on defense.
Pop formation for the Tigers. Skyler Ross as well as Alex Jackson back to receive about the 40-yard line for the Bobcats. This one's a good high end over in punt. It'll be taken by Jackson on the near side. Jackson rushes across the 50 into Tiger territory before he's pushed out of bounds.
So we'll see Colin Murphy for the first time here in the second half. He scored four touchdowns, threw for two of them, and rushed for two on his own. He was quite the athlete in the first half of play.
Yeah, I mean, once again, the Murphy-to-Murphy connection. But the guy that's impressed me and really has continued to impress me is Ben Johnson. Whether it's running, passing, defense, he can do it all.
So let's see. Shotgun formation here to start the drive on their own. Or on the Tiger 44-yard line. Pitch going to go to Skyler Ross. Bobbles in the backfield. Works midside across the 40 to the 35. So on his feet. We're pushing forward with a handful of tacklers on his back across the 30 and down to the 28-yard line.
Yeah, one of the things Skyler Ross did on that play is, you know, he took the pitch out to the middle. And, you know, he was going to take it right through the tackles, hesitated a little bit, really, in a way, stopped, waited for some blockers to run by, and he just kept going straight up the middle.
It'll go for a Bobcat first down, so it'll be first and 10, ball on the Tiger 27-yard line. Bobcat's right on the left hash mark on the near side part of the field. One receiver set, tight end is Ben Johnson. Handoff will go to Ross right up the middle. Ross across the 20, rumbles and bumbles down to the 16-yard line, where he's tackled in the backfield by number 44 in Dylan Hurts.
Yeah, as the first signal has been.
It'll go for a Bobcat first down as Mick Moranic trying to get back up on the field. It looks like he had to tie his shoe before we could resume play. 9:53 left to go, third quarter. Bobcats fighting once again. Send a man in motion and the tight end and Ben Johnson. The handoff will go right up the middle across the 15 to the 10. Still working as Ben Johnson as he worked his way to the 9-yard line. Good strong carry by the junior halfback and Ben Johnson. 6'6", 213 pounds. He has been the focal point of this offensive run game when it's not been a handoff to Drew Potter or Skyler Ross. Dalton Mealy's in the backfield with a one tight end set. Sends a man in motion and Ben Johnson on the near side. Handoff will go to Mealy's. Mealy's right up the middle across the 5 to the 4. Still working his way. He gets finally pushed down at the 3-yard line. Dalton Mealy's a man we usually call on the defensive side of the ball, getting some carries here in the second half of play.
Yeah, right now, 9:08 left to go, 28-7. Jeff West, this is gut check time for him. I mean, even though it's a wide margin, they got to get some any type of momentum, you know, to start the second half.
So it'll be first and goal on the 4-yard line as Colin Murphy goes under center. 13 seconds left to go, play clock, strong I formation set. Handoff will go to Potter right up the middle, and he dives under the end zone for a Bobcat touchdown. Drew Potter had no problem getting into the end zone on that one.
It looks like they will go for the two-point conversion. But like you said, like we said during halftime, this team, they don't deviate away from the game plan. You know, they get things done.
Bobcats putting the foot on the throat of the Tiger defense and never saying die and never letting up. That has been the motto throughout this game. So with 8:47, the Bobcats get another score, and Garrett Cayley gets to come out for another kick. Zach Hebel will be the holder. Good snap. Hebel with the hold. Cayley with the kick. Up and good. So with that, Bobcats extend their lead. 34-7, third quarter of play. Tigers in desperate need of a response if they're going to have any hope here in this one. Play Kansas City's most popular four-man scramble. Over 7,800 yards, it's the Monster Mash at Dubs Dread. October 7th, call Dubs Dread Golf Club at 913-324-5005, dubsdreadgolfclub.com.
And one of the things, and one of the strategies I really want to see what Jeff West does, coming out, you know, on this series, down 35-7, do you keep running? Or do you keep throwing the football? Or do you try and get some runs? And it looks like we have
an injured player that is being carted off in a John Deere Gator on the near side part of your screen. As Tyler Ogden will come on to kick once again. Ogden, right-footed kicker, gets this one squarely off in the middle of his foot. Good strong kick. It'll bounce at the 23 and go out of bounds. And we'll see a hinky on the near side by the line judge. Welcome into 810varsity.com. If you're just now tuning in, we welcome you as always here on the Bobcat Sports Network. My name is Aaron Berlin, joined alongside by my color analyst and Andrew Hammond here this afternoon. Bobcats have been in control since really the first quarter of play day, and they've never looked back. They have led the entire game. They now lead it 35-7 with 8:47 left to go here in the third quarter. First round of district play, 3-3 Jefferson West visiting 6-0 Baser Linwood. So Ian Mullins will break the huddle and go under center under Brandon Vaught here in the third quarter of play. First drive for the Tigers as the handoff will go to Dylan Hewitt, who works left side and maybe gets back to the 35-yard line on the handoff.
Yeah, one of the things that, you know, we definitely want to see from, especially from the defense, not getting lax. Even though, you know, you're up 35-7, teams tend to do that a little bit. You know, we saw it with KU, the up 20-0, they got a little lax. So if you want to keep that intensity, keep that, you know, keep that fire going, especially for Baser Linwood with this big lead, got to keep the pressure on them.
All right, Mullins goes under center. Strong I formation set. Five down linemen for the Bobcats. Four linebackers with Caleb Hiss showing blitz. The pitch will go to Baranek. Baranek works left side across the 40. Still on his feet as he's pushed back. And he's going to go for a loss of yards. Maybe a loss of one. Nick Baranek, the senior running back, took the pitch by Ian Mullins on the left side part of your screen and tried to angle and cut that outside corner, but was met by a handful of Bobcat defenders. Ball right at about the 34-yard line. It'll be third and long. They need 11 yards, and they need to get to the 45-yard line of the Tigers to get a first down. Mullins goes under center. I formation set. One tight end. It'll be a pitch to Baranek. Baranek works left side across. Maybe gets to the 40. Needed 11 yards. Looks like he might have got three on the third down.
Looks like the punt, both punt units will come out. I'm actually really surprised, even though this 35-7 game is, you know, essentially out of reach, I'm surprised they ran it that on that play. I mean, trying instill some confidence in your offense a little bit by taking it downfield, trying throwing it.
Brad Kaler will come out, punt formation once again for the Tigers. Back deep or Alex Jackson as well as Skyler Ross. Good strong punt. 3 seconds of hang time here on that one as it'll bounce right about the 35, work its way across the 30 to the 29, where Brett Rickliffs will down it right there. So the Bobcats will come out. They'll get the ball on their own 29-yard line, working right to left as Colin Murphy will come out once again. There's really not much more you can say besides this offense has been spectacular here in this one.
I mean, you know, I would love to see how other schools are doing across state, especially in, you know, 5A, 6A, you know, even a lot of 2A schools, you know, a school like Smith Center, I believe they're 3A right now, but they're going to go back to 2A. I want to see how this offense matches up with some of the other ones.
Three receivers to the near side, sends a man in motion, and it's going to be a fumbled snap.
But we do have a penalty flag.
We do have a penalty flag on that one. Tanner Garber was going in motion on the false start by the offensive line of Baser. It was a missed snap before the play ever had a chance to develop. 6:47 left to go, third quarter of play. Again, we welcome you at 810varsity.com. You can watch this game as well as 25 others all across the 810varsity.com network. This is just the Baser Sports Network, a branch of 810varsity.com. 6:47 left to go. Shotgun formation. It'll be a pitch to Ross on the outside. Trying to cut the corner. Works across the 27 to the 30 and pushes his way to the 32. Good run by Skyler Ross on the pitch from Colin Murphy.
Man, once again, that offensive line doing an excellent job. You know, whether it's protecting the quarterback or, you know, shifting the offensive line, they've done just a spectacular job all game. Head coach Steve Hopkins has to be really proud of this offensive line that struggled a little bit last week with some penalties.
Murphy going to go under center. Josh Barnes once again, one setback. It'll be a fake handoff to Potter. Murphy rolls out near side. Play action pass. Going to throw it on the field. Intended receiver Tanner Garber as he falls onto the ground. It'll be a completed pass right at the 40-yard line. Good awareness by Colin Murphy to roll out to the near side. And that was one thing Coach Johnson said before the game for the Tigers, that they needed to contain and get pressure on Colin Murphy. But it's so hard when he rolls out. Murphy breaks the huddle once again and will go under center. Strong I formation set this time. Tanner Garber, top of your screen. Handoff will go near side of you. Drew Potter breaks the tackle, works his way across the 44, maybe to the 45. Needed to get to the 50 for a first down, but it'll be good yardage on second and 10. Correction, it was first and 10. It'll be second and 5 from the 44-yard line. Clock still ticking as we near our way down to 5 minutes and 35 seconds left to go in third quarter of play. So it'll be second and 5 from the 45. I formation set. Ben Johnson, the receiver, on the near side. Murphy drops back, going to throw near side. Ben Johnson, the receiver, incomplete pass as Johnson jumped up and tried to catch it. The coverage was broken up by Brett Rickless.
Yeah, well, third and 5 here, you have a lot of options. One of the things you want to do, I would even try, you know, try a pitch. You want to keep this thing on the ground a little bit, not go to the air too much, but, you know, trying to establish that ground game. Again, that offensive line, they've done an excellent job, so I'd look for a quarterback keeper here.
So it'll be third and 5 from the 35. They need to get to the to the 50 for a first down. Murphy going to step back, going to throw, plenty of time. Intended receiver, Caleb Hiss, at the 50 on the far side, works his way across the 45 into Tiger territory where he's finally brought down at the 43-yard line. So that offensive base are just continuing to push forward like they have so much here today.
And really all season long, I mean, it's like we just can't say enough. It seems like Steve Hopkins, and that's one of the things as a coach that you definitely love, and looks like we're going to move this thing back a little bit as there was some laundry on the field.
The weather may be cooling down, but you can still keep a hot tan. Stop at a Bass Tanning anytime and keep that glow all year long. Bass Tanning right across from Sonic on 40 Highway. 724-2288, where the beds are cool and the tans are hot. So they'll back it up to right before the 40-yard line. It's about an inch shy on the left hash mark. That's where the Bobcat offense will pick up. Drew Potter is a lone setback with three receivers to the top of your screen. Murphy wipes his hands on his white towel right at about the 34-yard line. Shotgun formation, drop back, looking far side. Hit as he throws, intended receiver Tanner Garver as he dives and catches the ball right at the 50-yard line.
It looks like they're going to say that was on the ground. It looked like it did maybe scuff the ground a little bit from my vantage point as he was trying to scoop that one back up. But it looks like it will be fourth down, so we'll see the punting unit up.
That'll
the
be a
Bobcats.
Big incomplete pass. We'll see the punting unit for just the second time today on the Bobcat offense. Special teams has not been a focus of interest or an interest of focus here for Steve Hopkins so far this year, as his team has averaged around 43 to 44 points per game. They've not really been in a close one yet, which might have a few fans worried as they work their way to the postseason.
Well, they have the previous history. I mean, look at last year's game, the first round of the state playoffs, you know, kind of overlooked an opponent and lost in an upset.
Punt up and away by Ben Johnson. It's a high one. Good hang time on this one as the Tigers are backing up and they're going to let this one bounce out of bounds, and it'll bounce inside the 5 and out at the 4. Good, strong punt by Ben Johnson. He can catch. He can run. He's a do-it-all junior at 6'6", 213 pounds.
And in football terms, that would be known as the coffin corner. Get it inside the 10 and the 5. And all of a sudden, you know, 96 yards to hoe for this Jeff West team.
So that's where Ian Mullins and the rest of the Tiger offense will come out pinned inside their own 5-yard line. That's where they will start this drive, right at the 4-yard line. 4 minutes, 56 seconds left. Baser has already scored here in the third quarter, which has extended their lead to 35-7. Tigers working left to right as Mullins goes under center. Strong eye formation set. One tight end, one receiver to the near side part of your screen. Moranic across the 10, still on his feet, works his way, angles right side up to the 14 before he's kind of shoestring tackled and brought down.
Yeah, one of the things you want to do, especially if you're the Tigers from Jefferson West, is especially if you're down 35-7, at this point you just want to avoid any further embarrassment in this one. You don't want to get that one big turnover or even a safety to even bring that score up even more.
Jefferson West trying to find some positive here in this one. They've thrown 4 interceptions here this afternoon. Mullins goes under a center, and Branson Vaught once again. One setback is Moranic. Handoff will go. It'll go to Hucher, who got maybe a gain of 1 on the short handoff. It was an offset I formation set. It'll be enough for a first down, so that'll move the chains a little bit 14-14 left to go. It'll be first and 10. Ball right at the 16-yard line of the Tigers. Tigers working left to right in their road white uniforms with black pants and black helmets. The Bobcats in their all-green uniforms with green helmets and a yellow Bobcat on the helmet. One setback again as Mullins goes under center. The handoff will go. It'll be to Herring. Herring works left side across the 20. Still on his feet. Has enough for the first down and then some as he squirts his way maybe 2 or 3 yards past the initial down marker.
Yeah, and that's the third time I've seen them run that misdirection end around. The first time it worked well, I believe it was on a fourth down play. The second time, they didn't get any yardage on that one off the blitz. But that time, catch them when they're napping, go for it.
So it'll be their second first down of this drive as the ball now resides at the 28-yard line. Left hash mark on the far side is where the Tigers' offense will set up as Mullins goes under center once again. Strong eye formation, one tight end to the near side. Handoff will go to Maronic. Maronic, full head of steam as he works his way across the 30 before he's tripped up at the 33. Good strong young run. It'll go for a gain of 4 yards.
And player slow to get up right there, but it looks like Maronic and some of the defenders. Looks like we have a defender down. Looks like that will be Jake Phillips.
Jake Phillips as he's hobbling off the field, and finally we have an official's timeout. Never like to see someone go down, especially when he struggled to the sideline as it was. He tried to get there on the strength of his own legs, but he finally collapsed to his knees, and he's right on the near side part of the field, about the 43-yard line. And this is just something you never like to see. You never like to see kids get hurt playing football, but it's really part of the game. And the Bobcats have had a season where they have not been plagued by injuries at all.
No, and that's when Steve Hopkins and this and the staff has to really just knock on wood every single time, every single practice, every single game they play. But you could see Phillips struggling to get up along with Mick Baranek on that run. It seemed like both of them got up, but then Phillips started to go down a little bit. He went down the first time, near the huddle, and then right when he got to the hash marks, he just went down again. But it looks like he is getting up on his own power, so that's always good to see.
It's always good to see as he's helped off the field. Let's pause a quick second for station identification. You listen to the home of high school sports. This is Baser Linwood football on the home for high school sports, 810varsity.com. And back to the action with Aaron Berlin and Jonas Nordman. Welcome back to Keister Field. Bobcats in complete control of this one here at 35-7 with 3:08 left to go, third quarter of play. It'll be second and 6 from the 32-yard line as the Tigers work left to right, trying to get into Bobcat territory for the first time this half. Handoff will go, is going to go to Mick Baranek, but before he ever got the ball, the play was called. It'll be encroachment on the defensive side. That's the second encroachment call we've seen on the defensive line for Baser so far this year.
And that's just simply not being disciplined, especially the second one in the game. I mean, it hasn't been, when they're up, or when they're tied. It's been when they're up big. That's just all about staying, keeping your head in the ball game every single play.
So let's move the ball forward 5 yards where it's now at the 39-yard line. First down marker, it'll be second and 1. They need to get to the 40. Tigers still in their own territory. I formation set. Handoff will go to Moranek right up the middle. Has the first down and then some as he works his way across midfield into Bobcat territory for the first time this half.
Yeah, had a little extracurricular activity between, looks like, 53 and 25 of both squads. But, going back to that run by Moranek, I mean, he really essentially got 10 yards, gained another 10 yards off of that second and 1. But, Moranek just ran very well. It seems like every time he gets the ball, he's just ready. I mean, and like I said, running with conviction. You got to have a running back that's angry and upset.
So it'll be first and 10, ball at the 45-yard line. They didn't roll it across the 50. Still Tiger ball, full out of steam as Moranek right up the middle, works his way to midfield of the Bobcat. And he might have gotten 4 yards here on that one.
Yeah, it looks like 2:12 left to go in this one, 35-17. And once again, something we've seen, it seems like we're repeating ourselves. But, Baser Linwood doing an excellent job running, Baser Linwood, Millville. And, good Lord, I'm getting all these teams in the
Jefferson West.
Yes. Getting all these teams mixed up. But Jefferson West running, moving the ball very, very efficiently. Can they come out with points is the key.
Two receivers to the near side, 5 down linemen for the Bobcats. I formation set, handoff will go right up the middle. Works his way across the 50 and into Bobcat territory. They moved it back again. We keep thinking they get their way into Bobcat territory, but it must not be happening. So head coach Steve Johnson trying to find some positives here in the second half of play for the Tigers.
Yeah, and this is a very, very young team. You know, one of the smallest schools. They just got into 4A. And, you know, like I said, with a very, very sophomore-laden team, this is something they can take lessons from. And, you know, this team will be around in the future. There is some talent across the board.
There are seven sophomores on each side part of the ball, and you can see the talent and speed. But they're going against a powerhouse in Baser here today. I formation set, two receivers to the near side, one tight end. Handoff will go to Moranic across the 50 to the 49, as he didn't get much room here on that one on the third and five.
Yeah, in a way, I kind of feel bad for the quarterback, Ian Mullins, right now. It seems like the ball has really been taken out of his hands, so to speak. You know, he has thrown the ball well at some points, but with a lot of the interceptions, that really has kind of limited the play calling. So, I mean, some of these situations right here, fourth and five, you expect them to put it in the air, but I have a feeling they're just going to try and run straight up the middle, even try, you know, go for the end around a reverse like they've done earlier.
So it'll be fourth and five, ball right at the 50. They need to get to the 45-yard line for the first down. Snap is good. Mullins dropped back, wants to throw, double coverage. Oh, and it's incomplete as Dalton Dean was the intended receiver on the left side part of the field. Mullins threw into double coverage, and it was an ill-advised throw on the quick three-set drop.
Even though it was into double coverage, they definitely got away with a little extracurricular activity as that ball was coming down.
So it'll be a turnover on down for the Tigers of the Baser Linwood offense will come out once again.
And we just actually got a score from Perry LeCompton, Tonganoxie. The score is Perry LeCompton 35, Tonganoxie 7. So, like we said, the point differential as the season goes on, we're going to be hearing those scores come down.
And it looks like we might have an illegal formation on, or correction, false start on the Bobcats. Bobcats have been penalized more than Jefferson West here today, and that's something you wouldn't expect to see from a team that starts mostly juniors and seniors.
Well, definitely. I mean, We were both there at Mill Valley for last week's game. One of the things that we were both surprised by is the amount of penalties both teams, especially based on Linwood, had being up as big as they were.
Shotgun formation, one setback. The pitch will go to Ross. Ross angles near side across the 45, across midfield into Tiger territory, and knocked down at the 47-yard line. Good, strong head of steam by Skyler Ross, able to bust through the A-gap and find his way to the near side part of the field.
Yeah, well, that's one of the things that I've really been impressed by Skyler Ross as the season has gone on. You know, he showed those spurts of, you know, those big bursts of speed, but tonight it's really been his coming out party.
Ross has taken over the duties as the feature back in front of Jesse Hiss. 35-7 as we walk into the fourth quarter of play. Bobcat fans, check out the game night special from Simple Simons, a free medium one-topping pizza with a purchase of a large specialty. Yes, a free medium pizza from Simple Simons with a large specialty. Carry out only. Special only good on Bobcat football game nights. Call 913-724-4141 and place your order now or visit them at BaserSimpleSimons.com. We move into the fourth quarter of play. Bobcats in control, 35-7 here in week 7 of the Kansas 4A high school season.
Yeah, one of the things I do want to give a shout-out to the 14 listeners that are watching us on 810 Varsity tonight, but also the fans from Jefferson West, whether you guys are watching on the computer screen at your home or you are here in the stands right now. One of the things that, you know, we're talking to the coaches before the game, it's a farm community, it's a blue-collar community, and you know, these fans really come out and support their team. Even though they don't have the numbers of Baser Linwood, they've been just as vocal on some of the positive plays tonight.
Jefferson West from the Big 6 or Big 7 conference. Fake handoff. Murphy wants to throw. Going to throw near side. Tanner Garber wide open. And he hit him in the chest and he dropped it. Tanner Garber was wide open and didn't have anyone within him for about 5 or 6 yards.
And I think Tanner Garber is pointing at the lights, but in a situation like that, when the ball is square in your chest, you can't blame the lights, homeboy. Can't blame the lights.
You got to catch it, especially if it hits you right in the chest. Colin Murphy cannot have placed that ball any better. Before Jefferson West, you mentioned it's a small town. They're one of the three or four smallest 4A schools, and they're put in a district where they're playing all Kansas City schools. Head coach Steve Johnson said they put Sumner on their schedule this year just because they wanted to go against a threat. A throw near side for Murphy as he hits Ben Johnson right about the 35-yard line. They'll move the chains forward, but he put Sumner on their schedule because they wanted them to adapt, because in their league, everyone likes to run the ball and get that full head of steam. Why don't you come up here and you play these other teams? And they're mostly spread offenses, a little bit more of athletic of a player, different style of coaching. And so he said he put the Sabres on there just so his team could adapt and figure out what they're going to go against. But that was week one. This was 5 weeks later.
Yeah, that's one of the things you sometimes want to do. I'll finish my point after this play.
And the handoff will go to Dalton Mealy's, who works right side. Maybe he gets a gain of one or two. Correction, Ben Potter on the carry.
Or Drew Potter, it looks like.
Drew Potter. I'm getting my Ben Johnsons and my Drew Potters and my Dalton Mealy's and everyone mixed up here this afternoon.
Well, when they're all contributing like they are, it's hard to differentiate who's doing what. But one of the things that you talked about is getting that experience. I mean, I definitely agree with you. Maybe they try to schedule them later on in the season so you could get that seamless transition from one team to the next.
Murphy will go under center, 10:57 left to go, 2nd and 8. Handoff will go near side. Skyler Ross finds a hole and works his way across the 20. Dalton Mealy's on the carry instead of Skangler Ross.
And I want to say he ran into, looks like, Ryan Murphy on that play as he was had that burst of speed once again tonight.
Again, we welcome you into 810varsity.com. You can catch this game and others on our home base at 810varsity.com. Just click under the Gamecast tab. You can find this game as well as others all there at 810varsity.com. Strong eye formation set as Murphy goes under center. Ryan Murphy, his brother, and they got an encroachment on the defensive side of the ball. As you can see, Ryan Murphy clapping and applause at that call. It'll go against the Tigers, and it'll back it up an additional 5 yards, something Jefferson West did not need.
And this is the last thing you want, like you said, 35-7, 10:32 left to go. At this point, you just want to, walk out with the pride a little bit. But, if it's a 28-point loss or even, could be a 35-point loss depending on what happens right here.
10:21, first down and 5 yards to go. Skyler Ross works near side, gets close to the first down marker, may be a yard short as he busted right up through the middle. And it will be a Bobcat first down as they'll move the chains. That'll be 1st and 9. Ball inside the red zone. Bobcats have been very efficient when driving today, as they've only had to punt twice. It looks like we may have a stoppage of play. And with that, the weather may be cooling down, but you can still keep a hot tan. Stop at a Bass Tanning anytime and keep that glow all year long. Bass Tanning right across from Sonic on 40 Highway, 724-2288. Where the beds are cool and the tans are hot. Bass Tanning, make sure to stop by there as the winter season approaches.
We should go there sometime.
I don't know if I'm necessarily one for tanning.
Well, I am.
10:05 left to go, fourth quarter. Shotgun formation. Murphy going to step back, going to throw into Ryan Murphy's hands as he jumped up and caught it for a Bobcat touchdown. Big touchdown grab by Ryan Murphy on the brother-to-brother connection, and it certainly seems like they're doing nothing but playing pitch and catch all day long.
Well, yeah, and, that's one thing that, Steve Johnson talked to us before the game is we wanted to limit that. They haven't done that. And even that last throw, once again, I wish we had the advent of replay, because he threw that into, you could say, and you could argue that was into triple coverage, just threw it right to him, and it was a bullet. But now 41-7, 10 minutes approximately left to go on this one.
It was a spot-on pass for Colin Murphy to his brother Ryan Murphy. Good snap and hold by Zach Hebel as Garrett Cayley's kick is up and through the uprights. That extends the lead. Let's move it to 42-7 in favor of the Bobcats. This one has not been close since the starting seconds.
Well, and like we said, that turning point in the ball game was that tipped interception, that multiple tip interception. While Jefferson West was driving down the field down 8-0, it turned into 15-0, which turned into even more points for the Bobcats. And this team, I'm trying to figure out what can stop this team. It seems like really only themselves, and so far they haven't.
Let's pause 10 seconds for station identification. This is Baser Linwood Football on the home for high school sports, 810varsity.com. And back to the action with Aaron Berlin and Jonas Nordman. Welcome back to 810varsity.com. As Bobcats will come on to kick once again. Jefferson set to receive. There will be going right to left across her radio dial. Be taken right at the 20. Works his way across the 25 to the 30. Finds a hole and is tripped up right before he hit it. You can credit Aaron Brooks on the carry, the sophomore.
It'll be interesting to see what both teams do coming back on the series. Well, you know, with the score being 42-7, you know, will the starters get a shot, or not even get a shot, but maybe get a final shot, or it looks like a new batch of players are going to be coming in. But now it looks like these starters for Jeff West are staying in, as are the same starters for Basin Lumen. But one of the things you want to see, or I notice, is Jake Phillips. He walked off with an injury, but he is okay now.
Mullins and the Tigers will start this drive right at the 36-yard line. Shotgun formation, four receivers set. Handoff will go, and it'll go right up the middle. Maybe he gets a gain as two, as Wyatt Miller was on the carry. He had a shoestring tackle but kind of wiggled his way for an additional 2 yards after he was wrapped up in the backfield. So with 9:42 left to play, fourth quarter of play, Bobcats in complete control of this one. 42-7 here on 810varsity.com. My name is Aaron Berlin, joined alongside by my color analyst this evening, Andrew Hammond, and we've seen quite the performance by the Baser offense. Shotgun formation, four down linemen for the Bobcats. Mullins rolls out, wants to throw, right-handed throw, throws pass incomplete as it goes midfield as Tanner Garber, the Bobcat defense, dove for it right in the middle of the yellow Bobcat.
And avoided disaster once again. It seems like every time he drops back to throw, you know, these Jeff West fans and even some of the ones, you know, some of our 13 viewers watching on 810varsity.com have been holding their breath, you know, thinking what's next.
And what's next is a third down and 11 for the Tigers. As Mullins breaks the huddle, they'll come out in a shotgun formation. Two receivers to the top of your screen, one to the near side. One setback with them back at about the 30-yard line. Belt high snap. Mullins wants to throw. Going to throw far side. Overthrows Jordan Herring, the intended receiver, as it skied high and went out of bounds at the 41-yard line.
It looks like there will be punting, but no. Excuse me. No, they will not. Look. Yeah, well, there was a bit of a discussion on the Jeff West sideline whether to go for it or not, but they decide they will bring the punt team out.
Punt formation for the Tigers as Brad Kaler will come out to punt once again. It's his fifth punt of the afternoon as the Tigers have been stalled on their own territory numerous occasions. Alex Jackson as well as Skyler Ross are back to return this one right about the 30-yard line. Line drive punt, it bounces at the 45 and squeaks its way past the 50 and into Bobcat territory where it will be down right in the middle of the teeth of the Bobcat at midfield.
And once again, we will see kind of the million-dollar question. Is Steve Hopkins going to, I won't say call off the dogs, but take the starters out? And it looks like he will not, so full speed ahead.
42-7 lead for the Bobcats here in the fourth quarter of play. They'll start this drive with 9:03 left to go on the clock in their own territory as Zach Hevel will replace Colin Murphy at the quarterback position. Drew Potter also out for this one. As it looks like we have a whole new set of wide receivers. Ryan Murphy and Ben Johnson are still in the game for the Bobcats. Johnson, one tight end set. Hevel going to go under. It'll be a pitch to Skyler Ross. Ross angles near side across the 45. Works his way to the 50 and a big hit right at the 47-yard line, but powers through and dives down at the 50.
Yeah, that's one of the things I'm really impressed with. Skyler Ross, you know, yeah, just running between tackles, going outside, bouncing to the outside. Like I said, going through the tackles. Taking a lot of big hits, especially when it goes inside, but he's popping back up and ready to go.
Zach Hevel, the junior quarterback for the Bobcats, expected to replace the senior Colin Murphy next year. Murphy has held the reins of this Bobcat offense for the past 2 or 3 years. I formation set for Hevel. He's got two receivers top of the screen. Handoff will go right up the middle across the 50 to the 48. As Paul Ream, the junior running back, works his way into Tiger territory.
Looks like we'll be seeing just a lot of the running game so far, and you know, to end the ball game right here with 8:09 left to go. I mean, and Aaron, I mean, we've seen this team multiple weeks. I've been doing games with David Elliott for Podcast Sports, but you know, just being impressed with this team, how impressed are you with this team? It seems like everything they do, even though they've had the penalties and stuff, it seems like they're just efficient every single time they're out here.
Yeah, they certainly like to put numbers up in a hurry. Man in motion will be Dalton Enloe as he works his way to the top of the screen. The pitch will go to Alex Jackson. Jackson tried to get to the 50, but was hit in the backfield by the Tigers and never had a chance to cut the corner. So it'll be 4th and 4 with 7 minutes and 30 seconds left to go, and we'll see punt formation once again. Ben Johnson had a nice punt last time out where he downed the Tigers inside their own 5-yard line. It was a beautiful punt. It went for over 55 yards and had a hang time of 3.5 seconds.
And one of the kind of the interesting and funny things about this is, you know, Ben Johnson, especially, it's one of the things you have to love at, you know, the lower class levels. He's more of a tight end than a punter. I mean, just, you know, look at the size and the frame, but he has. There's no way he would be punting if he went to the D1 level.
Punt formation, low snap. Johnson's punt is up. Good hang time of 3 seconds, 3.1 seconds. It'll be taken at the 20. Ingles right side across the 25. Finds a hole across the 30 to the 40. He's got a full head of steam. Skyler Ross is the only man that can patch him up as Mick Baranek took that ball at the 20-yard line and made something of it.
Yeah, and that's something definitely, you know, like we said, a very, very young team, sophomore-laden team in the Jefferson West Tigers. You know, they can definitely take something out of that, you know, knowing that, you know, they can move the ball efficiently, and they have been able to do it all game, but they only have that 7 points, and that's really due to the Basin Linwood defense and just, you know, simple young player mistakes.
6 minutes and 40 seconds left to go in the fourth quarter. Bobcats lead this one 42-7. They've led since the opening seconds on a big run by Drew Potter up the middle. Ian Mullins will go under center once again, and it looks like we have a timeout, Baser. And with that, we will take a timeout to you. Listen to the home of high school sports, 8tonvarsity.com. This is Baser Linwood football on the home for high school sports, 810varsity.com. And back to the action with Aaron Berlin and Jonas Nordman. Welcome back to Keister Field. Bobcats.
Without oil and natural.
Bobcats in complete control of this one here in the early going. They lead it here 42-7 with 6 minutes and 40 seconds left to go. Tigers driving, though. They're inside the Baser 43-yard line. Mullins goes under center. Strong eye formation set. The handoff will go to Mick Moranek, who's met right at the line of scrimmage and works his way to maybe the 42-yard line.
One of the things I've been impressed about Nick Moranek really all game is, you know, the fact that he's been running very, very well in and out of the tackles. You know, and he will be coming out of the game right here, but you know, this is a very young, like we keep stressing, this is a very young team, one of the youngest in 4A, seven sophomores on both sides of the ball. I mean, this team is going to be around in the future, and it'll be interesting to see what they do against Baser, really in these district matchups in the future.
Tristan Rickles will replace Moranek. The handoff will go near side. It's Herring across the 20, still on his feet to the 13, or correction of the 16. Jordan Herring saw a full head of steam and took it and angled near side.
Yeah, and I mean, that's the fourth or fifth time we've seen that, you know, that misdirection end around. And I just love how they run that play because they really, they just shift the defense over, you know, going the other way on that misdirection as the play is designed. And I mean, the key is that crackback block. Once he gets free on that edge, and I mean, they execute it almost every time other than one time today.
So it'll be 1st and 10, ball at the 17. Mullen goes under center, fake handoff. It'll go to Huter, who works his way up to the 14-yard line. Won't be enough for a first down, but it'll be decent yardage on 1st and 10. 5:26 left to go. 42-7 is your score here at Keister Field on the home for high school sports, A10Varsity.com. Dalton Enlow will come in. He will replace Caleb Hiss on the defensive side of the ball for the Bobcats. For Jefferson West, Josh Becker will come out of the game. Mullins will go under his center, and Brandon Vaught, the sophomore. So it'll be a sophomore dealing with a sophomore. Strong I formation set. One tight end to the far part of your screen. Handoff will go right up the middle, across the 10, so on his feet to the 4 before he's brought down. Big handoff to Wyatt Miller, the sophomore. The very young and inexperienced team for the Tigers.
And one of the things I've really been impressed with this Jefferson West team, even though the score is 42-7, is these kids haven't given up. I mean, they're still, playing hard, keeping their heads held high. And that, that's a great credit to the coaches for instilling that in these players.
So it'll be first and goal, ball at the 2-yard line for the Tigers, threatening to score. 12 seconds left to go on the play clock as Mullen goes under center. Handoff will go to Miller. Miller works his way across the 1. Did he get him to the goal line? And I think they stopped him just short. Wyatt Miller tried to push the pile forward but had nothing going.
May have actually lost a yard or two on that play, but looks like that's a pretty generous spot.
And it looks like they'll place it right in between the first and second yard. So they've got a yard and a half to go for the Tigers if they want to get in the end zone. They got in the end zone once in the first quarter, but they've been held scoreless here in the second. Mullins breaks the huddle and goes under center once again. The receiver on the near side is Grady Mindendorf. The handoff will go, and did he get in?
Yes, he did.
Touchdown, Tigers. It'll be the first one of the second half, and it'll shorten the lead to 42-13. As you like to see them finally get on the board here in the second half of play.
Yeah, I mean, like we said, it's not like these kids have given up. I mean, they've drove down the field, it seems like countless amount of times, but just had bad luck, whether it's, turnover on downs or, forced punts. Two interceptions in the first half that were inside the 10-yard line.
So Logan Herring will come on to kick the extra point. The kick is up, and it's a strong one right through the middle of the uprights. So with that score, Bayshore's lead dwindles a little bit, 42-14 in favor of the Bobcats here on 810varsity.com. Bayshore came into this game 6-0. They wanted to improve to 7-0. They have not lost a regular season game in 16 tries. That is an impressive stat. Last time Jefferson West visited Keister Field, they came away with a win on a playoff game. It was where they won that game by 3 touchdowns. A little bit of a revenge factor here as the Bobcats welcome them to their home turf once again.
Yeah, that, and we talked about, especially in district play, one of the things you want to do is first off, you got to get wins, and two, you got to do it impressively. So right now, sitting in the Catbird seat, the last check, I believe, Perry LeCompton was up on Tonganoxie. I believe that score was 35-7, so depending on how the point differential goes, if you're reading tomorrow's paper, you're going to see small boxes with the record and point differential of all the teams in Kansas high school football.
Alex Jackson saw Skyler Ross back to receive for the Bobcats. Logan Herring comes on to kick it. Right-handed kicker signals with his right hand, finally gets the signal from the referee. At the 41-yard line, starts to run forward. Herring's kick is up, and it's a small one. It's a squib kick. It'll be hit right at the 40-yard line. Oh, and a big hit right at the 40-yard line.
Looks like the fans that are clad in green and gold wanted the late hit, but that's one of those things the referee just didn't see right there. So with 3:45 left, you just expect basically put it on cruise control, just run it out a little bit. Maybe the Jefferson West Tigers have one more shot.
We had a capacity crowd to start the game here at Keister Field. It is now starting to look bare, as you can start to see some of the silver that lines the bleachers here on the main grandstand. The Jefferson West fans are on the far side part of the screen. They have a whole section dedicated to themselves, a little bit of over an hour of drive, so a good strong showing by the Tigers fans. Handoff will go to Jackson left side as he spun down in the backfield at about the 33-yard line. Again, if you're new to 810varsity.com, you can catch this Bayshore game as well as next week's Bayshore home game against Tonganoxie In the second round of district plays, the Tigers will look, or the Bobcats will look to go 2-0. They had a strong showing here this week. Hope to have a good one against the Chieftains. Of course, the top two finishers in each district will advance to the Kansas 4A state playoff, and that's where the Bobcats want to get back. They want to have redemption for that early round exit against the Sumners last year. Hevel goes under center. The handoff will go to Jackson, who goes right up the middle and maybe gets to the 35-yard line. It'll go for a gain of maybe 2 yards. The initial line of scrimmage is the 36-yard line.
Yeah, you were talking about district play a little bit, and you know, especially for Jefferson West, yeah, this loss in the first round of district play does not mean they're completely out of it. When point differential comes into handy, like I was saying, is you know, say if they are tied with, for example, Tonganoxie at the end of district play, they'll look at the records and the they'll look at district record and what they did points wise. So if if Jeff West can get the ball back, get some points on the board a little bit, you know, you never know. A late touchdown with the less than a minute left may be the points they need to get into the 4A state playoffs.
Basically, lets the play clock dwindle down to 6 seconds left before they call their final timeout of the game. 2 minutes and 14 seconds left to go, fourth quarter of play. This one pretty much decided. It's Baser in the driver's seat, 42-14 here on 810varsity.com. Again, play Nick and Jake's Real Food Honest Drink. Nick and Jake's the proud title sponsor of 810varsity.com. Check out our promotions throughout the season on Facebook or on Twitter at Nick and Jake's. Play Kansas City's most popular four-man scramble over 7,800 yards. It's the Monster Mash at Dubs Dread October 7th. Call Dubs Dread Golf Club at 913-324-5005 or visit DubsDreadGolfClub.com. Huddle breaks and we'll see Zach Hevel back out to command another series for the Bobcats. He goes under center, offset, I formation. The pitch will go to Ross. Ross angles in up the middle, still on his feet across the 40 to the 43 before he's ripped down. Correction, it was Alex Jackson on the carry, as Ross and Jackson kind of have a similar build, but I should have known Jackson wears the black socks. 1:55 left to go. Fourth quarter is the final seconds of this one. Ticked down on a 4th-and-3 opportunity. Ben Johnson will come out to punt once again. He's had great hang time on his first two punts at around 3.1 and 3.5 seconds. Johnson back at about the 32-yard line as the two back deep for the Tigers are right at about the 27-yard line. Punt formation for the Bobcats on the 4th-and-3. Punt by Ben Johnson is up. It's a clear punt. It's a high one. Skied high. It'll bounce right at the 43-yard line. A hang time of about 5 seconds.
But we do have a penalty running into the kicker, so that will be, it looks like, possibly an additional 15 yards. And it looks like Baser will retain possession.
And that is exactly not what the Tigers needed here with just a minute 13. You'd like to see them put together a successful series. They still got to go play next week, and I believe they play Perry and Lecompton in a big game.
Yeah, and if Jeff West does upset Perry Lecompton, and this is where it gets fun and interesting. Next week, the district title could be on the line. If, like I said, if Jeff West upsets Perry Lecompton and Baser gets a win, that means your district champion will be the Baser Linwood Bobcats.
It'll move the Bobcats ball into Tiger territory again, right at about the 42-yard line is where this down the series will go. First and 10, ball at the 42 as Zach Hevel goes under center. Offset I formation. The pitch will go to Jackson. Jackson angles right side, cuts back up the middle across the 40 to the 35-yard line. Won't be enough for a first down, but it'll be good yardage on first and 10. Under a minute left to go here at Keister Field as fans start to find their way to the exit here as we take under 50 seconds. Play clock yet to start as it looks like we might have an officials timeout.
Looks like they want to get some substitutions in for both teams. Looks like we have a player down. Looks like it's going to be Drake Bird, the junior fullback and linebacker.
Drake Bird, who has played on both sides of the ball here today. He started on the offensive side, has been one of the main linebackers for the Tigers throughout this game. I believe he leads the team in tackles for this game. Bobcats will take the football right at about the 37-yard line, and it looks like they will go into the victory formation as Zach Hevel was protected on both his right and left side. Hevel is going to let the play clock tick down past 15 seconds. The game clock is right at about 35 seconds. Under 10 seconds now on the play clock as Hevel goes under center. Snap is done and Hevel downs it on the right knee. So with 25 seconds left to go on the clock, that'll do it here from Chrysler Field. Bobcats a winner once again. They improved to 7-0 on the center, but more importantly, they pick up a win in the first round of district play. Bobcats win this one 42-14. For Andrew Hammond, my name is Aaron Berlin. This has been a production on the Baser Television Network. We'll be right back next week as Baser takes on Tonganoxie Chieftain. Same time, same place, Heister Field, 810varsity.com. We'll bring that for you. Bobcats a winner. They win this one 42-14.